very warm welcome and a very warm afternoon to Pendle in Lancashire for the British National Road Race Championships. All the best riders in the country are here ready to race over one of the most savage national courses in recent memory. Only one of them will earn the right to wear the red, white and blue stripes of the British National Champion. And one man who knows exactly how that feels is Rob Hales. Rob, within your 15-year professional career, that must have been one of the real standout highlights.
Yeah, definitely. You know, I've had Olympic and world medals and world titles on the track, but also, you know, the national title on the road is something very, very special. To get to wear that jersey on so many occasions on the road like you do is something very, very special and very dear to my heart, and something that I will always cherish.
You won it 2 years ago in Yorkshire, very different conditions than what we're going to face today. How much of a part will the heat here in Lancashire play?
It's going to play a massive part here. You know, as you said, it's a savage course. There's a lot of climbing, an awful lot of climbing, and the heat will just magnify that. And it's going to be a real war of attrition out there. It's a very, very difficult circuit. You know, the women 8 laps, the men 15 mm-hmm. laps. And it is going to be savage. We're going to use this word a lot today, I think, but there's going to be an awful lot of people coming out the back of the race in both of the races today.
And will the heat be a big factor, especially when you've got guys that ride regularly on the continent competing against the domestics? Presumably it's got to favour the lads who are used to racing in France and Spain and Belgium, where it's a lot warmer than it is here.
Definitely. You know, you've got the guys who are there conditioned for this. You know, you've got quite a few of the guys here, a good handful, who are going to be riding the Tour de France. You've got guys who have ridden the Giro, you know, the Vuelta later on at the end of the year. They're used to these conditions. Here in the UK, the domestic guys, we're not quite, although we've had a fairly decent summer up to now, we're just not used to it, and we're not, especially on the climbs here. It's going to be very, very difficult for a lot of riders.
It's a brilliant field, isn't it? We've got more Tour de France riders wearing GB colours than we've ever had before coming up this year, and most of them are here. It's a tremendous lineup.
We've got 10% of the peloton today in the men's race who are, you know, they are full continental professionals. We've got a good handful who are going on to the Tour de France next week. So the level of this race is massive now.
You obviously had a little look around the course a while ago, and unfortunately for you, we actually had a camera on you while you were huffing and puffing around the 7.5 mile lap.
Right, so here we are in the village of Barley on the start and finish line. I'm now going to take you around the course and show you what the riders are going to face. So, straight out of the start, first stop, the Pendle Inn. For a quick pint, not even done 500 metres, and we're already going up. Quite a technical little climb, this one. Not too bad here on my own, but at the start of the race, give me a lot of riders trying to fill this bit of road. When they're racing, they'll be a little bit bigger the first few laps, but again, these climbs on this circuit, just a massive wearing down process. On their own, this climb is significant, but 15 times up here, you're gonna have to watch yourself. But this climb is just going on and on. As far as I can see now, we're still climbing. How is it?
Hard.
Hard. Everyone we've asked, how's the climb? What are we thinking? Tough. We're there. You can see for miles. Alright, so we've just come off the top of the descent now. We're coming into a sharp right-hander with a cattle grid on. So the riders will all be in the left-hand gutter here, ready to make the bend. Not too much gravel. Easy does it. See, now that's how you go past Ross Downing on the climb. Right, we're now onto the top part of the descent. The riders here in the race are going to be doing approaching 50 miles an hour. This will also be a section of the race now. If there's a very small group together, a few riders coming into the finish, a little bit of jostling and very nervous times. You know, only a couple of K now into the finish. But if there does happen to be one lone rider on his own coming into the finish, then he should have time to look round, straighten his jersey, and get his lucky hands in the air.
So are you not riding them tomorrow?
No, no.
Doing TV?
Horses for courses. And I'd be a donkey tomorrow.
Well, Rob, I was going to say that you made that look easy, but you didn't. I bet you're glad you only had to do one lap.
It was nasty, yeah. I was moaning like hell just to do the one. It's a very, very difficult circuit, you know, and again, with the weather. The roads are nice. There's not too much gravel. There's not too many potholes. There's a little bit of dead road out there, but most of it is nice tarmac. It's very good. A little bit technical, but it's just up or it's down. And it's going to be quite stressful for some of the riders, especially on the descents. There's not going to be an awful lot of recovery because there's going to be the nervous energy of the riders, you know, trying to stay upright on the descents because it's quite narrow. There's a lot of walls, so you can't see around the bends. And then where you've not got the walls, you've got a lot of the hedgerows. And obviously, the weather that we've had, there's an awful lot of greenery out there.
Beautiful scenery. It's an absolutely gorgeous area here, but they'll not really be thinking about that as they rattle past. Whenever you were out there, did you get the sensation that we might have, you know, what happened last year? We had a guy, Christian House, who was accused by some people maybe of not working hard enough during the race and then had the legs to win at a sprint. It's probably not going to come down to that this year.
Yeah, no, I mean, for Christian, you know, he was in a group of four and three of the guys were doing an awful lot of work. Two of them did more than they needed to do. And so that kind of magnified the fact that Christian basically played the racing card. He just sat in and he waited for the sprint and he took the victory, you know. Here, there's not going to be any chance of that, I don't think. We've got so much climbing that even if you are in the wheels, you're going to be doing all of the work on yourself, unfortunately. So today, you're not going to have a lucky victor at all. There's going to be the strongest man is going to come out on top.
Let's talk about the women's race as well. Nicole Cook, absolutely dominant in this event for over a decade now. Do you think she'll win it again today?
You know, she's going for a 10th on the trot. She's had 10 in the last 11 years. That is one hell of a record. Circuit suitor, she is a tough, gritty rider, obviously. You know, she's Olympic champion, she's been world champion. Emma Pooley, though, for me, has probably got the nod. She's in fantastic form this year. She's a very small rider. This circuit will suit her probably more than Nicole, but Nicole is, you know, never, ever discount her at all.
Who's the pressure on here, Rob?
I think probably Pooley. You know, she's going to want to win. Nicole, you know, she's won it so many times, it's almost been a foregone conclusion. Has she got the pressure on her? It's whatever that she puts on herself. But Emma Pooley, she should go out there and just do the race that she knows she can do. She should be confident.
So Nicole Cook is the one to beat. Let's take a look at the riders then that are out to get her. Emma Pooley won the silver medal in the time trial at the Beijing Olympics, and she could be the rider to end Nicole Cook's unbeaten run in the national championship. Runner-up in 2008 and third last year, she'll be hoping to make it onto the top step of the podium this time.
You enjoy the climbs, and tomorrow's course should play into your hands a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, it's a tough circuit, much tougher than last year. But, I mean, Lizzie can climb, Sharon can climb, Nicole can climb, all the young TV girls, Kath Hare's climbing really well. It's, you know, it's far from, you know, made for me. If it was maybe, you know, an uphill 30k road race, then it would be even more my cup of tea. But yeah, I mean, that's the nice thing about road cycling is it is influenced by the course, but it's, you know, you have to be smart as a rider and you have to play, you know, even when it's not your strength, maybe you have to try and win. So
you must be quite looking forward to it then.
Yeah, I'm just looking forward to the race. It'll be fun. Yeah.
Riding alongside Pulley for the Cervelo test team is Lizzie Armistead. She successfully made the transition from track to road when she finished runner-up in last year's race. This time she wants to go one better.
It's difficult. You come back from the national championships and the only person or the results people have seen is Nicole Cook's results. But you know, we have beaten her several times in Europe this year. It's not something that is unknown to me to beat Nicole Cook. So it's not the challenge isn't too big. I think it's motivational, really.
Sarah Story is a remarkable athlete. She has won no less than 7 gold medals at the Paralympics, 2 in cycling and 5 in swimming. She now competes against able-bodied athletes and won the 3K track pursuit at the national championships in 2008 and 2009.
There's no pressure on me tomorrow because, you know, I've just got to try and keep learning and try new tactics and, you know, see what's, you know, going to help me to win or try and defend my paracycling road world title. And then with the Paralympic Games having the road race in as well in London, you know, it's just an opportunity for me to pitch myself against, you know, the best riders in the world and see what happens. And so long as I come out of it having learned something, then, you know, that's all that matters. So I'm looking forward to having a stab.
Well, those are the women that we've identified as being the most likely to challenge Nicole Cook. Do you think we got that just about right, Rob?
Yeah, definitely. I think with the Cervelo test team, with Emma Pooley, she's got Sharon Laws and Lizzie Armistead. Lizzie, a fantastic rider in her own right. Sharon Laws is someone who is proven on a circuit like this to look after a team leader. So there's a fantastic threesome there.
Should be a very interesting race and a very challenging circuit. All the best of the action coming up here next. Well, there were 60 starters in the women's race early this morning. Beautiful sunny conditions it was. They're all wearing their sunglasses. Setting off on what was supposed to be 8 laps. Enjoyed the conditions early on. They climbed well. But unfortunately, without even a lap completed, this happened. A big smash on one of the descents. And a lot of the women who were following at the back of the peloton smashed into the cars, which couldn't get through those little narrow streets. The race had to be neutralized. All the girls slowed down. The race was stopped. Eventually we got it restarted though, but unfortunately now they're only going to be doing 4 laps rather than 8. So a shortened race, unfortunately, for the women, but it's gone pretty much as we expected. Nicole Cook in a leading break of 4, being challenged by the 3 Cervelo girls, Sharon Laws, Emma Pooley and Lizzie Armistead. They're challenging her all the way. We're into the last lap. Let's join our commentators, Brian Smith and Anthony McCrossan.
Well, thanks very much, Graham. It is as we expected as the riders make their way onto the final loop of 12 kilometres. And we have these 4 riders together, and it is a fantastic group of 4 riders. Nicole Cook, Lizzie Armistead, Sharon Laws and Emma Pooley. Nicole Cook, of course, completely outnumbered by the Cervelo test team riders, who are the 3 riders in black. But it's going to be all about these climbs, Brian, because we would expect, of course, Emma Pooley to try and break Nicole Cook on this final climb.
Well, the reduced distance of this women's race is meant that it might not be as long and tough as everybody thought it was. I think Nicole Cook, if she could be in the last position, you know, 2 or more riders just join, because they're not really, you know, they're all looking at each other, nothing's happening.
Look at this though, Brian. We were looking at a group of 4 riders, and now we have got a group of 6, because 2 riders have jumped across to the Cervelo test team group and Nicole Cook group. And in this, the 2 riders who've just made the junction, Emma Trott wearing number 31 and at number 11 Katie Colclough. This has completely changed now the shape of this race, because of course Katie Colclough and Emma Trott, the 2 riders who've just made the junction, have been teammates of Nicole Cook all season.
Well, this is playing into Nicole Cook's hands, because before we had 3 Cervelo test team riders, Nicole Cook in the right hand side of the screen just taking a drink out her bottle at the moment. If she could have the chance right from the start of this race to be in with a shout in the last lap with the 3 Cervelo test, she would take it. She's in a great position at the moment, but there's been lack of cohesion, I think, with the Cervelo test team. They've not really went on the attack, made it hard enough for Nicole Cook. She's still in with a shout and she'll be the happy one.
Well, we're looking here at the chasing group, and there's a few more riders riders, I think, who are going to maybe even get here. Nicole Cook puts in a huge turn on the climb, because there we are, we can see the World Championship bands around the jersey. She is concerned about the rider on the right-hand side, Emma Pooley, and the red, white and black colours of Cervelo, the rider who has been on form all season, and Cook is desperately trying to get back onto the wheel.
Well, she's zigzagging all over the road, and she really had Nicole Cook in the back foot there. She sets up and Nicole Cook comes up alongside. Nicole Cook has to keep on pushing on. If she sets up here, the other riders from Cervelo Testing, who look to be struggling at the moment, get over the top of this climb, it's them to attack, but she goes again on the right-hand side.
Well, Nicole Cook this morning, she looked so focused on the start line. You can tell when Nicole is focused and ready, she just stares dead ahead on the start line. That's what she did this morning. She glances around. Pooley looks so easy, but if we get to the flat road, Pooley will be not on her main territory, and then the whole thing will flip to Lizzie Armistead and Nicole Cook. Now they're doing almost track stands on this climb.
Well, it is a national championship. There is a jersey. Nicole Cook has won it 10 times. She's won it 9 times in a row. The Cervelo test team with numerical numbers really have to keep on hitting Nicole. It's not happening. And more riders are still in there with a shout. And if these can come back, go straight on the attack, who knows? It could be all over for even Cervelo test team and Nicole Cook in front. So they have to keep on going. Some negative riding at the moment just goes to show you, Anthony, that this national championship means a lot to these four girls in front.
Cook injects a little bit more pace. She's being matched with every single hammer blow that she puts into the Cervelo test team by one of the riders. She's absolutely flying up this climb, but Pooley looks very, very easy, calm, focused. And now Pooley makes a jump. It's a little bit like watching Alberto Contador, the way he attacks on Alduez. Cook goes again.
This is absolutely amazing when you think three Cervelo test team riders, Nicole Cook, really up against at the moment. A lot of riders came back at the bottom of this climb, and Nicole Cook, full of fight, she really wants to win this national championship again. It's really up to Pooley to distance herself from Nicole, and she's not been able to do this at the moment. If I was Emma, I'd probably try and sit back, get our teammates to try and attack over the top of this climb, because it's looking very good for Nicole Cook at this moment in time.
Lizzie Armistead, she's starting to feel the heat out here, and believe me, there are searing temperatures, and it's not just about the heat that these three riders are putting on each other. It is boiling hot out here. Pooley looking at Nicole Cook, who clicks her way through the gears. Armistead has got to get herself back on here, because she will be the rider for Cervelo test team and could win the sprint. And as we speak, she does.
Well, it's looking like a great effort here by the Cervelo test team riders. They are outnumbered, we keep on saying this. Nicole Cook at the front. Nicole just has to keep the pressure on, get over the top of this climb. But thinking now, she goes on the attack again. The two strongest riders for me in this front group of four, it's Nicole Cook at the front and Emma Pooley sitting in the second place.
Nicole Cook has had a difficult year last year, but this season she's felt that bit by bit the form is coming back. She finished just behind Emma Pooley on the podium of Flesh Vallon, one of the toughest one-day classics. And she said, I haven't been on the podium of the World Cup for 2 years. Now Sharon Laws starts to accelerate. The Cervelo test team really are trying to outwit Nicole Cook, but the strength and the character of the Olympic and world champion is not being outdone. She is showing her true class here on this climb.
Well, Cervelo testing, we've seen what they should be doing. Keep on attacking. Nicole Cook goes again. She knows she has to keep the pressure on, because as soon as she sits up, a Cervelo testing rider in the black is going to attack. So she keeps the pressure on, and again, it's only Pooley that's able to follow.
Well, Emma Pooley, I spoke to her yesterday. She's fresh from winning the Giro del Trentino. She looks around, she says to Sharon Laws, you've got to get back up here. I need your help. She doesn't want to go it alone. She's saying, get up here now. Come on, I need you to have extra numbers so we can outclass Nicole Cook at the finish. Here they go, down this descent. It's all about teamwork. Speaking to Emma yesterday, she said, I've had wins when I wasn't really expecting it. The win in Giro del Trentino in Italy recently, she'd had a break. She wasn't looking to win, but she's so happy in this Cervelo test team with the way they ride, the equipment they've got and everything else, that she just feels confident. She knows she's got two good teammates, and the wins just come with the morale.
I'll tell you what, Anthony, I think this national championship is just drifting slightly away from Emma Pulley at the moment. That was a big opportunity there in the hard part of the climb to distance Nicole Cook. It's not happened. She's sitting on, she's looking back, she's waiting for her two other teammates, because she knows, I think, the only way to beat Nicole Cook is get down off these moorlands into the finishing area, and there's still an opportunity for Liz Armistead to beat Nicole Cook in the sprint. So that's why Nicole Cook is keeping on, putting the pressure on, because in this situation, two riders, she's going to be coming out the winner at the end of the stage today. And look at the two riders just coming back, and that's sitting in perfectly for Cervelo Test Team. That's why Emma Pulley's just sat at the back at the moment.
Emma Pulley's got a race face on. Look at that. How focused is this rider? Last season, when she lost in Abergavenny, she was pretty much inconsolable at the finish. She just stared, she looked, she just couldn't believe she'd been beaten at the finish. This rider, of course, finished on the podium, Lizzie Armistead, who is using her track speed now. She isn't a climber, but she's absolutely flying down this descent over the cattle grid, desperately trying to get back on, as Sharon Laws just sits in the gap there, Brian, just trying to give her a carrot to chase, and then they'll work together to come back.
Well, just look at the duo in front, Nicole, keeping the pressure on. Emma Pulley just sitting on the wheel at the moment. She's waiting for Sharon Laws and Armistead to come back. Looking at the moment for Cervelo Test Team coming off this climb at the moment. There's still a couple of wee climbs to go. I think strength wise Nicole Cook has got it today, and the only way she can be beaten is by possibly Liz Armistead when it comes to a sprint finish, and she goes again.
Well, she looks around and she just desperately doesn't want those two riders to make the junction. She's making it as difficult as she possibly can. I'm trying to think back to the last time I saw Nicole Cook ride like this, and I think it was maybe even the Olympic Games. This national title that she has won 9 times in a row, 10 times in total, she's completely made her own, and she wants to try and equal or better the record of course, the record holder who's got more wins than anybody else. Here she goes, look at Lizzie Armistead. Onto the front now, these two riders working well to come back.
Yeah, the record is held by Beryl Burton at the moment, and Nicole Cook really wants to surpass that, and she's doing a fantastic. I really impressed with Nicole Cook today, up against the 3 Cervelo Test Team riders in the black. She's really, just seeing the strength at the moment, pushing on. She knows if she can get to the finish with only one Cervelo Test Team rider, she stands a good chance of winning this race. Now we have the next small climb here. Emma Pulley really needs to go on the attack now.
Emma Pulley and the other two riders from Cervelo Test Team spent the night in Hebden Bridge before they made their way up here for the start. They spent all their season pretty much abroad. And talking to Lizzie Armistead yesterday, she said, yep, spent all my time in Belgium, and then during the winter I'm pretty much homeless, really. Now they're onto the climb. Pooley with that familiar style, looking easy. Wonder where the three chasers are. They got dropped on the major climb. Emma Trott, Katie Colclough, who were in that group that just dropped off the bag. If these four riders mess around, then they could come back again on the run into the finish. But Pooley now on the front and doesn't really want to do that, because Cook will be able to track every single move.
Well, she's given Nicole Cook a wee bit of a breather now. I would think that on this climb, that Emma really sitting on the wheel of Nicole Cook for so long, it really has to... they really have to go for it, and it looks as if that she's looking round, she's seen where Armistead is, and I think they're looking at Armistead to try and bring this title home for them.
Sharon Laws looks a little bit laboured at the back, but she's a fantastic bike rider. 2008 national time trial champion is Sharon Laws. There she goes again, and she's trying to now hurt Nicole Cook's legs. It's just 1, 2, 3. They keep attacking and attacking. Lizzie Armistead is just going to sit on now and not do an awful lot. Cook looks around. Look at this. How outnumbered is she?
Well, it's all small efforts by the riders in black there. And again, Laws tries to go at the moment. And Nicole Cook matching them. She's just letting a wee bit of gap go. She wants to have a wee look at the other riders behind. She'll attack now and bring Laws back. She doesn't want anybody to go away, but she was just trying to lull the other two, Pulley and Armistead, into a bit of sense of security. And for me, Nicole Cook is riding an outer skin today, and a group of four up against three other from one team, it's going to be very difficult to pull on that national champs jersey at the finish of this race. But very, very impressed with Nicole Cook, the Welsh girls riding today.
Nicole Cook spent yesterday riding around the course, getting used to it, trying to work out, I think, how to win this race. Here's the chasing group again. We've got in here Emma Trott wearing number 31. Natalie Creswick of the Twickenham CC. She's in very, very good company in here, wearing number 60 at the front. And number 11 is Katie Colclough. So these three riders still riding well, and it is good to see Emma Trott and, of course, Katie Colclough back in here and riding well. The riders, Emma Trott, of course, was one of those Great Britain Academy riders who was unfortunately hit by a car a couple of months ago. They've fought their way back to fitness now and is in with a chance, if they can catch the leaders, of getting a medal. But the rider from the Twickenham CC, Creswick, great to see her in here.
Oh, fantastic. She's not been in the reckoning pretty much all this race today, and great to see her up there. You've got to remember, there is a race within the race at the moment, as Lodge tries to go again in this short climb. There is a race in the race. It's an under 23 race. Armistead in the front group here, just in the middle of our picture in the black. It looks as if she's leading that competition, but just behind you've got Trott and Colclough, and they're also under 23. So there is a race within a race. The race for the national champs jersey that Nicole Cook is going again for, but there's an opportunity for some of these riders from behind to come back and try and take that under 23 crown.
Well, look at Nicole Cook rocking and rolling that bike left and right. She has been unable to get rid of Lizzie Armistead and Emma Pooley. She's got rid of Sharon Laws. Of course, Sharon Laws, a former teammate of Nicole Cook when they rode a couple of years ago for the Halfords team. But now they're up against each other. And remember, of course, in the Olympic road race, they were teammates. Here is Nicole Cook's attack. Look at the determination on her face. Those legs must be really hurting, even though we're in a shorter race than we expected.
Well, it doesn't make it any easier. The four riders now coming back together. Everybody's really looking at this national title, and you know, Emma Pooley, slightly disappointing for me here. She's tried to have a go. She should consistently keep on going. She's riding at the front now. For me, I think it's going to come down to four women's sprint here.
Well, remember last year in Abergavenny, it was Emma Pooley, Lizzie Armistead and Nicole Cook who raced into the finish. Lizzie Armistead was really disappointed at the finish because she said, if I'd led into the last corner, I could have beaten Nicole in the sprint. But they let Nicole lead it out, the long straight into Abergavenny. It played completely into her hands in front of a Welsh crowd, of course, and she took the victory yet again. But there are not really any springboards for Emma Pooley to win this race now. It's going to be about working as a teammate, and that's what team racing's all about in cycling.
It's about team racing, and Cervelo totally riding as a team at the moment, looking after each other, looking around to see where everybody is. Unfortunately for them, they've got, you know, a rider on form at the moment, and that's Nicole Cook sitting in second place. She's loving it at the moment. She's shown really strong. I'm thinking, would this make any difference if it was eight laps? I'm thinking at the end of the day, especially for the rider at the front, Emma Pooley, and on these eight laps, I think it would have been slightly harder, slightly longer, and it would have played into the hands for Emma Pooley. But now, being a wee bit shorter, unfortunately, that crash, just hope all the girls are okay. But Emma Pooley looks as if she's riding for Lizzie Armistead for a sprint finish today.
Well, the crash, of course, also took out a couple of riders that we may have expected to be in this group. I know that last year's fourth place rider, Kath Williamson, she was held up by that crash. We may have expected her to put in a performance today and be in the leading group, but the pace very high now as Pooley turns her attention to riding to make sure that the team in black are the team who stand on number one in the podium.
Well, they stand a good chance of two medals here at least. you know, they could take all three, but I think Nicole Cook going to be very difficult to beat today. She's sitting in second place. Emma Pula just leading out at the moment. Doesn't look as if it's going to come in for a sprint. Looking at the service cars behind, it's neutral service. So I think this gap is still within 30 seconds. So there's still an opportunity for Trott, Colcliffe and Creswick to come back. But not now, because Emma Pulley's on the front and she's going to be leading out into Barley for a sprint finish here in the Women's National Championship.
Well, look at this, as Emma Pulley now desperately tries to take Lizzie Armistead and Sharon Laws to the finish. I don't think she's going to give it a good old go, because she knows that Armistead has a very fast sprint. Here we go, this is the chaser, and this is Katie Colcliffe, number 11 for 100% me, in the red and white colours. It's great to see her back on form after she was in that accident when they got hit by a car. So great to see her in this race even. Pooley now on the front, Cook in second place, Armistead in third, Sharon Laws in fourth. They go up over this little riser, twists and turns of this course. And when you think about Emma Pooley, second in 2008, third in 2009, an Olympic silver medalist, and without doubt is the top rider in the world this year. They're not too far from the finish, and now they will be going through in their heads, how do I win this British title?
Well, Colcliffe, I think, leaving a wee bit too late to try and come across, because Emma Pulley stretching them out at the front. She knows she's got other two teammates here. Just watch number two, Giddle, just taking a drink at the moment, sitting in third place on the perfect wheel, and that's Nicole Cooks. So Emma Pulley, as Nicole Cook just throws the bottle, she doesn't need any extra weight. We're getting within sight of the finish now. Emma Pulley in the front, leading out. Number one on her back is Nicole Cook, going to be finishing off 10 in a row.
Here we go now, we're heading towards the finish, and the first move starts to happen as the rider from the back goes on the attack now, and that's Sharon Laws. Armistead immediately onto the wheel of Nicole Cook. Emma Pooley isn't going to get on the podium by the looks of things, as Nicole Cook looks across at Lizzie Armistead, and they are going to sandwich her out. Here goes Emma Pooley on the right hand side as she goes back to the front. Cook just biding her time, waiting to see what moves the Cervelo test team make, as Pooley goes to the front yet again. Armistead is still there. Last year she was the under 23 champion, and we are now heading close to the finish as Cook goes on the left hand side, and she gets tracked immediately by Lizzie Armistead.
Well, perfect move there by Lizzie Armistead, just tracking Nicole Cook the whole time. She knows it's going to come down to a sprint, and that small effort there by Nicole Cook says to me that she's not overly confident of winning this sprint. She knows how fast Armistead is. Emma Pooley comes straight to the front again, leads it out. This is going to be a close finishing here.
Well, there we are, there's the replay. As Pooley went to the front, Cook looked round and said, it's not up to me to do the work here, because I'm the rider who is being outnumbered by all of you. That's them going through the feeding area. As Pooley looks around yet again, they will be talking to each other. I said to them last night, do you have a race plan? Do you have something sorted out? Lizzie Armistead said, no, haven't got anything. Now Emma Pooley decides to go as they head towards the finish, and the two Cervelo riders are not going to do any work at all with Nicole Cook, who is desperately now trying to come back up to the wheel. Emma Pooley's riding away. This is perfect teamwork. Well, who would have expected her to go on the run into the finish? And Armistead knows that if no one goes through, then Armistead will sprint off the wheel of Nicole Cook. Look at this. Here we go. Emma Pooley has flown from the group, and now the Cervelo riders look around and say, it's up to you, Nicole. We're not going to do anything. Our teammates up the road, and Armistead freewheels. Well, we were talking about the fact that Emma Pooley had not used the strength on the climbs to win the national championship, but she attacks at the absolute perfect moment. Look at this. The rider who we would expect to attack on the hills is going to ride to the finish, and I tell you, this is going to be an emotional one. Emma Pooley wins the national championship, and she's almost in tears. She's pretty exhausted. She cannot believe that, and I don't know if I can either. Armistead takes second, Cook I think took third, and Sharon Laws took fourth. Well, there you go. Outwit them by using a tactic you weren't expecting.
They did wear Nicole Cook out there. We did think that the best chance for Emma Pooley to win was to go on the climb. Unfortunately, you know, for as we see the winner there, totally happy. Unfortunately for Nicole Cook, she was just outdone in the last kilometre there.
Well, they're just congratulating each other. It was a shorter race, four laps. We were talking about weather. The fact that the race was shortened would play into the hands of Nicole Cook and out of the hands of Emma Purley. But she's got the win that she has desperately, desperately wanted. Second in 2008, third in 2009, but now Emma Purley is the champion. Here we go back to the rider who has been chasing them, Katie Colclough, fifth in 2009, second in the under 23 title also last year, and she's going to ride into the finish now in fifth place.
Well, still a great performance there by Katie Colclough. It's going to be a silver medal in under 23 result for her, and you know, a fifth place on the day, so a great result, showing her strength and keeping it going all the way to the line here.
She goes in that kit which is worn by the Olympic Academy. They're based over in Belgium. They are looked after over there and guided all the time. But perfect team tactics. We talk about cycling as a team sport, and that was a perfect indication of what team riding is all about. If you have the strength in numbers, you can outdo a national champion. Well, let's hear from Graham, who's down with the champion.
Emma, finally dethroned the champion. Nicole, how do you feel?
I'm just really surprised, actually, because I thought that if I couldn't get away on one of the climbs, then there was no way I could win it. You know, I was sure by the final lap, I knew I couldn't drop Nicole on the hills. She's really strong at the moment, and so I thought it would come down to a small group and a sprint, and for me, I mean, without being defeatist, I'm that's not my strength, so I was pretty much resigned to coming last from that group, but I think that actually it played to my advantage, because everyone knows I'm crap at sprinting, so they weren't looking at me, and I suddenly had a gap, and I was like, right, well, I'm not waiting there. So I'm pretty surprised.
When the race was shortened, did you think that was probably your best chance gone?
Yeah, because, I mean, that is a really tough circuit, but it's only tough if you do it enough times. You know, one lap is not, it's a hard, hilly circuit, but yeah, and I mean, the reduction from 8 to 4 is just, yeah, to be honest, I mean, I have all the sympathy for the organiser, because it's very hard to get an ambulance onto that narrow course, and I'm really sorry for the girls who crashed, but I just wish they'd thought about it in advance a bit, because, you know, cutting our race down to half the length, it really changes how it is, and I ate so much pasta last night, and I've only burned off half of it.
Well, a rider who can barely control her excitement, Emma Purley, a champion of the road race. She is the first rider to wear the national champion's jersey since Ceres Gilfillan, because Nicole Cook has won that title for 9 years in a row. But here in Barley and Pendle, a great setting for a national championship. And we're going to enjoy, I'm sure, the podium presentations very shortly indeed, when Emma Purley will be presented with that all-important red, white and blue jersey that, of course, she will be able to wear for the rest of the year. Look at that. There she is, riding across the line, and a very emotional rider indeed. Here is the top 10. Joe Rousell, one of our world track champions, there in 10th place. Sarah Story in 9th. A great performance from Creswick there in 7th. But Pooley's a champion, with Armistead in silver and Cook in 3rd place.
So congratulations to Emma Purley. To be fair to you, Rob, you called that early doors, but I don't suppose you expected when the race was shortened that she could actually go on and win it.
Well, you know, when they shortened the race to half distance over four laps after that horrible crash that they
had on
the original
first lap. Thank you very much, everybody. Emma, can I just get a quick word with you?
You know, the newly crowned champion. For me to play into Nicole Cook's hands slightly short, you know, Emma Purley's fitness would have come in later on in the race. But as it was, you know, that was a fair outcome, and the girls rode really well. Nicole Cook, fantastic. I mean, what a fight she put up against three Cervelo riders.
Emma was quite funny at the end of it when she said, listen, okay, we were there as a team, but we weren't really riding as a team, but we didn't attack her, but they did work for each other, didn't they?
You know, at the end of the day, the girls didn't ride against each other, and it was down to Nicole Cook. You know, at the end of the day, that's what happens. That's how it works. It's bike racing. But Nicole, she put up a fantastic fight. But Emma Pooley, when she put that last move in on that last little kick, it was game over for everyone else.
So Emma Pooley is the new British national champion. We've got all the best of the men's action coming up here after the break.
Put in for me. It must have been 10.
Welcome back to Pendle in Lancashire. We're here for the British National Road Race Championships. We've already seen Emma Pooley walk away with the women's title. We've got the men's race coming up soon. Also coming up, by the way, here in Eurosport. Eurosport and Eurosport HD. Saturday, next Saturday, 4 p.m. The start of the Tour de France. We're live from the prologue. But back to what happened here a little earlier. And we had, of course, a horrendous crash on the first lap of the women's race. This is one of the bikes that did not survive that crash. This belonged to Catherine Williamson. Rob, did you ever have a bike that ended up in this sort of state?
It's quite a mess, isn't it? Yeah, one or two over the years, but I'm still walking, no problem. And Catherine, fortunately, she got back into the race, but her bike didn't.
By the way, we didn't add this bit of grass for effect. That bit of grass ended up on the wheel after that crash. Is any of this salvageable, Rob, or I have to get rid of it?
There'll be one or two pieces. The bottles will be okay, but that's about it now. This is one's for the bin, unfortunately.
Well, the race did get underway after that. Emma Pooley won it. As for the men's race, the defending champion is Christian House.
It's Kenyuk on the left-hand side. Christian House on the right-hand side in black. And it's House. Christian House.
To be national champions, something that I've dreamt about since being a junior, so to actually have to be national champion now and the past year that I've had in Jersey has been unbelievable. The amount of publicity you've got out of it and the way people respond to you has been amazing, and just to wear the jersey, I've been incredibly proud to do so, and I hope people think I've done it justice.
Don't be fooled by the accent. Christian really is British.
I was born in the UK, and I moved over to the States when I was about 6 years old. So, I spent a couple of years up north in New Jersey, and then the bulk of my kind of time in America was spent in Austin, Texas, a place which I still consider home. It's kind of a funny saying that I consider myself Texan but not American, if that makes any sense whatsoever.
House joined the Rafa Condor Sharp team in 2008, and his aggressive riding style was a major factor in winning the national title last year, and has continued to bring success in this year's Tour Series. But to retain the champion's jersey, House will have to contend with the tough Pendle course.
The course is going to suit me. It's on circuits. The course itself is quite hard, so there's a wearing down process, which is always going to be good for me. Last year the course was, I wouldn't say it was similar, but in the way that it wore riders down, it was similar. So again, it suited me quite well.
And as for race tactics, well, he knows only one way.
You know, I come to these races to race and to try and, either win myself or help my team win. So, there's no point in sitting back and not doing anything, especially when you know that your team does well when the race is hard. So it makes sense that somebody from our team does that. And yeah, it ends up being me a lot of the time, but that's all right, I enjoy it.
So at some point in today's race, expect to see Christian House at the front, giving us all to have the honour of wearing that white jersey for another year.
Well, that was Christian House's superb victory in Abergavenny last year. Rob, you were in that race, but you probably didn't see that much of Christian.
I got to see it from the sidelines. I lasted about three quarters of the race, but then I got to see on the finishing circuit all the action that was going on. And yeah, Christian, he rode a fantastic race. He sat in, let the others do the attacking and the bringing back, and then at the finish, got his hands in the air.
What are the chances of him defending the title here today?
Well, out of the domestic-based riders, he is one of the top riders that we think will do that, along with Simon Richardson, who at the moment is in the front break. The conditions suit him. He likes it hot. It's hilly. The course is, he won't be too scared of that. So yeah, definitely one of the top domestic guys.
Will be very hard work for him today, though. He's in exalted company today. Here's a couple of the riders we've picked out to watch.
With 10 stage wins in the Tour de France, Mark Cavendish is the fastest sprinter in the world, but today's race isn't ideally suited to his style of riding.
It should be pretty good. For me, it's not really my type of circuit, I don't think. You know, give it 100%, never say never, but you know, it's pretty hard circuit. It does take a lot of willpower to complete that at the end. It's just going to be, you know, man oh man, just grunt whoever's got it at the end, and it's just going to be a slog for the finishing.
Despite having conquered the Alps and Pyrenees, David Miller starts the national championship with a certain amount of trepidation.
Yeah, I'm quite excited actually. I mean, it's ridiculously hard. Not ridiculously hard, it is. It is ridiculously hard. I worked it out and it's like 4,000, over 4,000 metres climbing, which is the same as a big mountain stage in a Grand Tour. So, I mean, that's, even if it was at the highest level pro race, we'd all be terrified of the course alone. So, I mean, I think it's going to be a savage race. And I think a third of the way through, there's going to be just a handful of people left going for the win.
Olympic gold medal winner Geraint Thomas will be riding the Tour de France this year. He'd love to do it wearing the national jersey.
To be at the Tour with the jersey on as well, you know, just representing the country, and don't get any bigger than that. So yeah, it's definitely a massive inspiration, especially being in Sky as well, British team, and you know, with Brad and Steve there as well. And yeah, it'd be massive, but obviously there's a lot of 130 other guys that want to win it as well. So, and we rode down the circuit today and it's tough, you know, it's going to be a worthy winner, that's for sure.
Dan Lloyd is also making his debut in the Tour de France next month after a late call-up, but he's got unfinished business with the National.
Now, once you win it, as you well know, you get to wear the stripes for a whole year, and this year it would just be fantastic. Now I've just got the news that I'm doing the Tour de France, to be able to, you know, wear it during the Tour, and people can really sort of pick you out then, and you get, you know, a lot of publicity from that. So I'm always up for it, as you know, I'm always up for it each year, sort of give it my best shot, and I've been close the last 3 years, so you know, hopefully this year will be the one.
Well, Rob, much of this will come down to a battle between the domestic riders, the domestic teams, and the famous pro riders who've graced us with their presence here.
Yeah, it's always the case, you know, it's a different style of racing, but the domestic guys will be in the forefront for that style of racing, but on these conditions, on this course, it's got to go to the continental-based guys.
Well, they're out there racing at the moment. We'll be going to the live action very shortly, but let's take a quick check at what's happened so far.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, away they go.
Really was a superb day. It is a superb day for a bike race here in Pendle, in the northwest of England. So all the big name teams are here in a big field. Really hot day for a race that didn't seem to bother Jeremy Hunt, though. He attacked pretty much immediately. Former winner here in the national championships. A few guys at the back struggling in the early stages, the hills and the temperature taking its toll. Jeremy Hunt out on his own. He was soon reeled in, though, with the group that involved Geraint Thomas of Team Sky.
Well, that was the early stage of the race. Geraint Thomas was then joined by another two Sky Pro Cycling riders in a breakaway group of five. They're being chased hard now, though, by another group of three. Let's go to live commentary now. Brian Smith and Anthony McCrossan.
Well, thanks very much, Graham. As we look down now on the breakaway group peering through the trees to try and find them. Well, it's an interesting breakaway group as we look at the man in the red and black there, Simon Richardson. There are three riders from Team Sky in this leading group, and the Team Sky car comes alongside them to give them a little bit of information. Here's a confirmation of the group: Ian Stannard, Geraint Thomas, Simon Richardson, Peter Kenyuk, and Jeremy Hunt, who really, so far, at the back of this group, in the red, white and black of Cervelo Test Team with a jersey untipped all the way down, is the man of the race so far, because he's barely been in the peloton today. Here's the chasers.
Well, he attacked with one, you know, just after one lap of the first time up the hill. Jeremy Hunt, he's already won this British Championship twice. Can he do it for the third time and make history, because nobody has won it three times? So Jeremy Hunt just sitting at the back, because at the end of the day, as we saw this morning, three Cervelo riders against the Nicole Cook. Now we've got three Sky riders in black, just chatting to each other at the front of this five-man group. The two riders behind riding terrifically today, and that's Jeremy Hunt and Simon Richardson. But all they have to do is sit on, because they know the racing is still to come.
Geraint Thomas on the front there, looking very, very comfortable indeed. Just to go back as to how these riders eventually got there,
Well, so Hunt went on the attack, as we've already seen. He kind of rode just away and nonchalantly looked around to wonder where everyone else was as they go through the finish line to complete another lap. And he kind of looked like, where is everybody else? Is anyone going to try and ride across to me? Geraint Thomas and Simon Richardson raced across at the end of the second lap. Then Adam Blythe of Omega Pharma Lotto and James Moss of Endura Racing tried to get across. They didn't make it. Then out of nowhere, Peter Kenyuk and Ian Stannard suddenly raced across the gap, jumped into this front group. And this has been pretty much the case since the end of the second lap, beginning of the third.
Well, it just looks as if it's a carbon copy of the women's race. The strong riders going out front early on and maintaining that all the way to the finish. Still a long way to go. We've just gone through with five laps to go, so there's still time for some riders to come across from behind. But as we believe, there are about three chasers at the moment. They are struggling. David Miller is in that group. I think Ian Bibby from Motorpoint and also Dan Fleeman is also in there as well. So three strong riders trying to come across. These five riders, especially the Sky riders at the front of Thomas, Kenyuk and Stannard, they'll start to tire because they are doing the majority of the work at the moment. Because they've got three riders in this five-man group, on the right-hand side, Sigma Sports Simon Richardson, at the back, the experienced Jeremy Hunt, just have to sit there because they know they're outnumbered, and for them to win, just a wee bit like Nicole Cook winning this morning, it's going to be very, very difficult.
It's interesting in this group that we look at Simon Richardson there in the black and red of the Sigma Sports squad. He's the only non-continental based rider. You know, he rides for a team that is what we call a continental team in cycling, but he's against Pro Tour riders in Team Sky, the very highest level in terms of the license a team can get. The second stage down is a team like Jeremy Hunt's for Cervelo Test Team. Simon Richardson is a British based squad with a British sponsor, and he's in here. And we think about the Premier calendar this year. He's won the Tour of the Reservoir. He's been riding really, really well. A former mountain biker, which is maybe why this race is suiting him so much.
Oh, it's a mountain climbing. We just heard the interview with David Miller. It's like a Tour de France stage with the mountain climbing we've got here. Just noticed that Ian Stannard has drifted slightly back. He looks to be probably the weakest of the three Sky riders in front. Simon Richardson just coming to the front for Sigma Sport on this climb. Jeremy Hunt absolutely doing nothing. Being on the attack from lap one, and just sitting there and sitting there. Because at the end of the day, he's one person. There's three riders in black and white in front of them. Back to the chasing group. Bibby for Motorpoint, another excellent, good rider. Dan Fleeman just in front of the white for Rally, and at the front there, David Miller, one of the other favourites of this race today.
Ian Bibby grabs a bottle. It's so warm out here. Over the last hour or so, the temperature has dropped a little bit. There's some cloud cover. Previously, it was exceptionally warm. But Bibby has been feasted on, really, Criterium racing, town centre racing, for about the last month and a half, with some Premier Calendar races in Great Britain added in for a little bit more ingredient. But he's riding really strongly in here. This gives you an indication now of the climb, as Peter Kenyuk at the front has just come out of riding the Dauphiné in support of the man on second wheel, Geraint Thomas, who of course wore the green jersey throughout that Dauphiné. And Peter Kenyuk really was his main domestique in the mountains as they start to lap a rider. Dan Patton is caught.
Yeah, Peter Kenyuk just flicks his elbow at the moment. Very talented young rider. Still a young rider, but we go back to the next chasing group on the road, the third group on the road, and that's Andrew Fenn at the back, 100% me, and Dave Clark. Another outside opportunity for the Pendragon rider at the front in the blue to do well. An excellent climber, but just struggling a wee bit as we head to this feeding zone here.
Very busy feeding zone. They've got some more bottles on. Dave Clark of this smaller team from Britain in the blue colours, Pendragon Lacolle Fulnago, a teammate of course of Yanto Barker. Dave Clark is a talented bike rider. He certainly is, as he goes to the front to just try and get himself across. And Andrew Fenn of 100% B. Back onto the climb, and Richardson starting to set a pretty hot pace up this rise. he is, and I'm not too sure he should be doing that. There's three Sky riders, three Pro Tour riders in this front group here. He should be leaving it all up to them, saving as much as he can, because he's going to need it if he's going to finish on the podium today. Stannard comes through, does his turn. Pierre Kenyon looking so smooth at the moment. He's got a whole entourage over from Niall Aman, came here today to support him. He gets tremendous support, Niall Aman. I think he was the strongest rider in last year's event, and he looks very, very strong today.
Well, we think about last year. He was third in 2009. He was second in 2008. He's been the under-23 champion on two occasions. That's the man sitting second wheel in this group. He's a young man, but he's got a real load of experience on his shoulders. He was a member of the Olympic Academy programme based down in Italy, and he's just talent. He uses it.
Yeah, super talent. But just looking at the back, it's a big length for Jeremy Hunt just off the back at the moment. He is starting to suffer. I was just about to say he's zipped down. He's been on the attack since lap one, struggling a wee bit. He is a very good sprinter, a very strong rider, and he's pushing it a wee bit to try and stay with this five-man group. But I think it's, you know, with when you come through to the finish, with four laps to go, it's going to get harder and harder and harder. But the question is, Anthony, is MD going to be able to make it across to this front group and try and pinch a medal? Because this race has been all about five riders so far.
Well, we've been told now that the advantage is 3 minutes and 48 seconds. It was hovering at around about the 2.5 minute mark, which says that the impetus is going out of that chase. And the pace being set by Peter Kenyon, Simon Richardson, is starting to dent the advantage now of the chaser's deficit. As Hunt goes across the right-hand side, he's taking a gel on board here. Just his body's obviously feeling like a bit tired. Oh, David Miller has gone to the cars. He may have a problem here, a mechanical, or he's stopping. But David Miller's race looks like it's about to come to an end.
It's all over, Anthony, and he's absolutely bonked. He's taken a can of coke out of the car. It's just been a severe, hard race today. And we knew, you know, the Scott, in these sort of conditions, it's going to be very, very difficult. He's just taken some coke on board, just absolutely hit the wall.
Well, it's not often we see this of David Miller, and his legs have completely emptied. He has nothing left. The man from Garmin Transitions, who described the race, of course, before the start as savage. More climbing than a mountain stage of the Tour de France, and that every rider would be worried, but Miller suddenly is at a standstill. Have you done this before?
Well, I've done it a few times in my career. It's not very good, and you know, he just wants to hide. You know, he knows the cameras are there. He knows he's in the spotlight. He's in that chasing group. Unfortunately, he never made it. They were eating into this group. It got to within close to 2 minutes from about over 4 minutes, I think the major gap was. So he closed it down, done a lot of riding. But all these three riders did in front of the Team Sky just sat back, lulled them in until it got to about 2 minutes. And then Rod Illingworth for Team Sky, Director Sports, must have went up alongside and said, "Guys, put a hammer down." And that's what's happened. David Miller's just popped, and he's left Ian Bibby of Motorpoint and Raleigh to try and salvage something for him. But I think with this gap going up and up and up, over 3 minutes and 48 seconds, I think the champion is going to come from this group of five in front.
Well, the chasing group has got, of course, Dan Fleeman in it and Andrew Fenn. They needed that extra advantage of having David Miller in there for Garmin Transitions. He's a great time trialist, he's a good climber, he's fresh out of the Dauphiné. They just needed that little extra, and maybe they're going to start to go backwards. The last time, just thinking back to the last time I remember seeing a rider like that, and in fact it was Jeremy Hunt. Early in the season, he was in the chasing group in one of the Belgian semi-classics, and he absolutely hit the wall, pouring with rain. It was actually the day that the rider who was in this group with him, Ian Stannard, finished third in Kerner Brussels Kerner, and Jeremy Hunt was trying to chase across. He hit the wall, he pulled across the side of the road, and he got in the team car. And Miller's doing the same today.
Well, back to this chasing group, Anthony, we get Dan Fleeman. He was with Cervelo Test Team last year, riding in the Continent. Now he's with Raleigh, doing a great performance here. Ian Bibby, a rider of the future, behind there just with the black and orange, a fantastic talent here in Britain. The two riders have got just domestic races under their belt. All the riders in front, apart from the Sigma Sport rider of Simon Richardson, domestic racing, but everybody's got fantastic racing. looking at the front group, Jeremy Hunt is starting to struggle. Simon Richardson, I think he should be just riding in the wheels at the moment. I don't think we've ever seen a 1-2-3 with one team in the national championships. Sky are in the driving seat and they really want to win this title, and what a way to win it if they took all the medals. I think Simon Richardson is the key to stop them doing that.
You have to take your hats off to them. They were under pressure before this race. Everyone was saying it has to be Team Sky. They want the jersey. They want the jersey for the Tour de France. And everyone is looking at them to do the race, take the race to everybody else. As the Sky car comes up yet again to have another conversation.
Yeah, normally what happens is, you know, when a group goes away right from the start, they let them go, and then the stronger riders, you know, go on the attack and try and come across to the group. That's not happened in these championships. Everybody's looked at this hard circuit thinking, I don't want to be left behind. This is so hard, this circuit, that I don't think I can close a 3 or 4 minute gap, you know, in a couple of laps. So the situation is, the stronger riders have come out from the gun in both the women's race, and we've seen the man's race, as we see the Sky team car up, talking to Kenyuk, talented young guy, and I think it's going to be a fight between the Sky riders, who's going to be pulling on his jersey.
Well, the look on Dave Clark's face tells the entire story. This is savage, as everyone has described. It is a complete war out here, and these riders, Clark now has dropped his chaser and the sweat is absolutely pouring off his nose. Can he get there on his own? You really have to question whether that is possible, but he is a rider who is prepared to just hammer away and see if he can get there. Great crowd out here just cheering these riders on as they head towards the real business end of this race, although I kind of sense that the business end has already happened, and that was maybe on the first lap when Jeremy Hunt went on the attack and absolutely ripped this race apart.
Well, talking about the domestic riders and the domestic teams, I had a word with them over the last couple of weeks, and everybody said this man here from Pendragon, excellent climber, he has got the potential to do a ride today. Unfortunately for him, David Miller has hit the wall, right? He's not had the riders to be able to help him. Andrew Fenn, the Scot, riding for 100% me, has just gone bang now. He's on his own. He's left too much. A 3 minute, 4 minute gap is just too much for one rider as we go back to the second group on the road.
Well, the Motorpoint team car comes alongside Ian Bibby. They're going to have a little bit of a conversation with him. Maybe just boost the morale up a little bit, help them, and maybe just give them a little bit more food and drink to fuel them up for the conclusion of this race. Back now to the leaders, led by Geraint Thomas, the green jersey for a few days in the Dauphiné. He'll head, of course, to the Tour de France. He's done a little bit of a Brad Wiggins, really. He's transformed himself from a track rider to a great road rider. Took a third place on the stage of the Dauphiné just a couple of weeks ago, and looking strong out here.
We were talking with the riders last night. The names that came out as the major favourites for this race is the two riders at the front. Rider in the middle of the picture, Peter Kenyon from Isle of Man, the youngster, laughing away at the front. He's absolutely loving this at the moment. On the right-hand side, Geraint Thomas, fresh from, the Criterium Dinofin. It's a very hard race, but they're the two riders that everybody thought are going to pull on this national champs jersey. Now they find themselves coming up to four laps to go, the two of them in the lead. It's going to go down to, you know, tactics between them, because at the end of the day, it's an individual race, and we saw that this morning with Team Cervelo tried to ride individually, but obviously riding as a team, these guys are going to make sure that a Sky rider wins this jersey. But who's it going to be?
That's the bet, really, isn't it? Ian Stannard, you wouldn't expect him really to be hauling that body over these climbs. He's one of the tallest and I guess heaviest riders in Team Sky, but he is looking very, very strong indeed in this group. And another rider with that familiar kind of hunch style, he looks very, very strong indeed. Right, so we're back onto the descent now. Jeremy Hunt's hanging back a little bit on this descent. Don't know whether it is because he is feeling the pace or whether he's just trying to hang back a bit.
Well, it is a very fast descent. They're just up on the bike at the moment, and the bike is struggling to keep out their way.
Well, so we see the riders going down the descent. We will be back just after this. as another of the Sky riders goes back to the team car to have another chat.
Well, we had a star-studded field this morning when this race took off. About 120 odd riders, and it's just a pity this race is split up from the, you know, the gun from lap one, and we weren't able to see some of the other stars like Mark Cavendish and Dan Lloyd and these sort of riders. So we've got five riders here. Pick your winner, because three Sky riders, and you think numerical numbers, like the woman this morning, they did numerical wonder numbers and they won. They left it late. I don't think they'll take this chance. Constant, the team car behind of Team Sky coming up, giving them drinks, giving them advice. They know they have to keep concentrating. This is a long, tough race. As Rob Hale said, this is savage. As David Miller said, this is savage. What we're saying, this is savage race. But it's going to go down to, I think it's going to go down to the wire. All these three riders, with Sky in their chest, want to pull on this this jersey. Do not forget the rider in the black for Cervelo, Jeremy Hunt, already twice a winner of the national championships. And the rider for me of the day is Simon Richardson, the domestic rider of Sigma Sports.
Well, we go through Jeremy Hunt's previous performances in this national championship, and he was the winner in 1997. That's quite a long time ago. The winner in 2001, second in 2003, and third in both 2002 and 2004. And we go back through Jeremy Hunt's experience as a professional bike rider, and he turned professional with, for those of you long-term fans of bike racing, for the team of Miguel Indurain, Banesto. He's been a top sprinter, he's won some fantastic races, and you can see there, he's pouring water over him, just trying to cool himself down a little bit. But Jeremy Hunt is without doubt the most experienced bike rider in this group, and I'm wondering whether, he's trying to cool himself down, whether Jeremy Hunt, the fact that he lives in Australia during the winter, might at some point towards the end of this race help him with this heat.
I'm not too sure anything's helping them with the heat. When you start pouring bottles of water over you, you need a constant supply, because it makes you feel, instantly it makes you feel a bit cooler, but in the long term it makes you feel warmer in about 5 minutes time. So you need a constant supply of water pouring it over yourself, because he's only going to feel that coolness for a very short period of time. He's missing a lot of turns. He has been on the attack from, you know, the first lap. He has won this, he's got a great palmarès when it comes to national championships, but for me, looking at his demeanour, looking at, you know, he's, the way he's riding at the moment, I think he's hanging on a wee bit, and he'll be looking for a medal possibly to add to the rest of his collection. I think it's going to be very difficult for Jeremy. Got to remember, he came to the fore as a predominantly a sprinter. He's one of the lead outs for Tor Hushov and Henrik Hausler, and he's not really suited to mountain stages. The mountain goats in this race is Thomas on the right hand side from Wales, you've got Kenyuk from Isle of Man, and we all know it's mountainous over there, and we've got Simon Richardson for Sigma Sport. So we've got four laps to go in the 2010 British Elite Championships.
Well, the crowd are enjoying the sunshine. We've got a giant screen in the area down there as well. The pubs are all open. This area, of course, the Forest of Bowland, an area of outstanding natural beauty. And today is being shown in its very, very best light. Jeremy Hunt now will just be trying to set himself up to get his mind set for this climb, which rises, of course, from... it rises about 300 feet to the top of Barley Lane. So from 700 feet to 1,000 feet... And it's going to be another test for him. He's got to just somehow summon the strength and the energy to stay there. But as you've said, Brian, he just now and then he just lets the gaps go, and he is definitely not going to go to the front.
Well, the attacks aren't going to come now. We're going to go into the last two laps, and I think that's where some of the riders are going to start going on the attack and trying to get the glory. The riders are going to be the Sky riders. If I was Simon Richardson, I'd be thinking, right, I'm going to save as much as possible and try and attack them first. As we go back to the second group on the road, Dan Fleeman and Ian Bibby are thinking no man's land at the moment. The gap going over 4 minutes, they're going to really struggle to get in the medals here. But you never know what happens in front. So they have to believe, they have to concentrate, and they have to realise this is a national championship. There are medals at stake for the first three. We've seen what happened to David Miller. It could happen to anybody in front, so they have to keep going.
Dan Fleeman there in the white of the Rally squad, the resurrected team. Of course, Rally has got such a stunning previous track record as a team. Of course, in the Tour de France, they won the Tour de France. They've won the Tour de France previously. We remember back to Laurent Fignon riding a Rally bike in the Tour de France. Dan Fleeman here was the champion, the under 23 champion in 2004, and he was eighth in this race in 2008. And he's had a really difficult season last year with the Cervelo test team. He broke his wrist. He never quite made it at that level. So he's come back to Britain. He said, right, okay, I'll be the leader of the Rally team. And we haven't really seen him put in a performance so far this year. But today he's changing that.
Well, Dan Fleeman is a huge talent. He is the national champion at hill climbing. And, today, how many climbs have he gone up? So he is suited to this. It's just a pity he never went with these moves earlier on in the race. Maybe thinking, I'm going to sit back. Rally did come to the front early on to try and keep the gap down to a minimum, but it's just too much at the moment for Dan Fleeman and Ian Bibby to come back to these riders at the front. As you see, the pace has settled down at the moment. They'll know that Dave Miller has went pop, so they'll settle it down and start concentrating, start thinking inside the last four laps, when am I going to make this move? When can I break the back of the other four riders to try and win this championship?
Well, a couple of nights ago, I spoke to the man who really owns the Sigma Sport Specialized team, the main sponsor, and he said, I can't wait for Sunday. I think we might do something. And his team is represented yet again as the only domestic team in the front group of this race. Richardson has been the real the man of the Premier calendar. He's the surprise man, I guess, of the Premier calendar this year. And he's in this group and he's riding well. And who would discount him jumping away at some point? We saw him win the Tour of the Reservoir earlier in the year, and he just uses a little climb as a springboard, because that mountain bike background means that he's used to this sort of terrain. He doesn't mind being in the climbs. Look at that lovely shot, the five riders across the road, and Jeremy Hunt's recovered enough maybe to go to the front, or is he just trying to set a pace that he's happy with?
I think more the latter, Anthony. He knows he's struggling, so he's just settled down the pace at the moment. Looking at the five riders, they know they're still, going to be 3.5 laps to go. They are near the top of this climb. Talking about Simon Richardson, great ride by him today. For me, people looking at this might thinking, I'm not going to say he's spoiled in Britain. I think he's an asset, riding Premier calendars, riding the crits and things like that. But I think he needs a chance of the big time in Europe. And if Sky don't pick him up, then somebody might be out there that might offer him a contract to live his dream and give him a chance to ride in the big races in Europe, because he deserves it on this performance only day. Back in 92, when Sean Yates beat me to the line in Kilmarnock, Sean Yates gave him a hard time, rode with him pretty much for about 80 or 90 miles, just us two up, holding off a group behind us. And everybody went to the continent, they asked about the British Championship. He gave me a huge recommendation that I gave turn for turn, and that allowed me to get that contract when I decided to go to Europe. So Simon Richardson might be following in that way.
Well, at the back of this group, of course, as we look here at the chasers, Ian Bibby in the orange colours of the Motorpoint team, Dan Fleeman in the white. Bibby is producing a great performance. That front group, of course, has got the team cars of the Cervelo test team and Team Sky, and they'll see the sort of ride that Simon Richards is putting in. I must say, Dan Fleeman still looks full of fight. He's still with it. He's not absolutely wrecked here. He looked around at one of his teammates who's standing at the side of the road there and gave him a little nod as he went round the corner. So he's still feeling a little bit sprightly.
Look, there's five in front, and when you count them, you count it's the talent of Geraint Thomas, the talent of Peter Kenyon, and it's also Simon Richardson. Right, we've seen David Miller go pop. He'll know that Jeremy Hunt is up there, not the best climber in the world, and he would admit that. Stannard, big strong lad. So these guys would be thinking, maybe we could sneak in for maybe a bronze medal, and that's why they have to keep calm. But they hit the bottom of the climb as the leaders went over the top of the climb, and that's roughly just over 4 minutes.
Well, we're saying here that the gap now has gone out to 5 minutes and 5 seconds, so it's growing all the time. I'm interested in the way that these riders are going up that main climb that earlier on in the programme we saw Rob Hales riding up there and overtaking Russell Downing. The different climbing styles, you'll notice that Simon Richardson is in a nice small gear, so is Peter Kenyon. But Jeremy Hunt's in a massive gear, he kind of grinds his way up there. Is that because he's tired? Is that because that's just Jeremy, that's the way he does it?
I think it's a combination of a few things. This has been a very difficult race. He is on form at the moment. I think there's been a bit of a truce in this group. They know that David Miller's not there. They know there's two riders behind 5 minutes and 5 seconds. They are inside the last four laps. A wee bit of a truce. They know they've been out front for a long, long period of time. They'll probably say, look, we're right together. Take it easy on the hardest bit of the climb. And then come into the last two laps, every man for themselves. You'll have a good race. And whoever's the strongest wins the national title, because every one of these five riders, still in with a shout, really desperately wants to wear that national champions jersey. I know, I've won it twice. It's my motivation. It's a great jersey to put on for 1 year, and it's so proud to have it. Looking at it at the moment, it could go either way. Sky at strength in numbers, and they've got some exceptional talent in this group of five. But do not discount Simon Richardson from Cyclosport, Jeremy Hunt in the back for the black, from the black for the Cervelo test team. He's experienced, he might be suffering at the moment, but you give him a sniff of a national title and his palmarès will show he'll give 100% for it.
And of course, Jeremy Hunt will be riding the Tour de France next weekend. He'll line up in Rotterdam, and it will be the first time he's done it. Yes. And he wants that jersey.
Yeah, 36. It's huge when he won these last two titles. Unfortunately, he wasn't selected for the Tour de France. Looking back the years, again talking about Sean Yates, the director of Team Sky, it was himself way back in when he won the title for myself in '92. Took the jersey to the Tour de France, gave it that kudos. It's about time that we got that back. And the only two riders in this breakaway of five is the Cervelo test team rider Jeremy Hunt, looks to be struggling, or Geraint Thomas, that can show off with pride the national champs jersey.
What an enticing prospect that is. And of course, here on Eurosport, we will be showing pretty much every minute of the Tour de France over the next 3 weeks. Unstinted coverage of the world's greatest bike race as we look down on these five leaders going along this unspoiled road, the walled road, and winding their way through the corners. Very, very fast descent that they will go down, where unfortunately we did have that crash in the women's race. These men are going to hit somewhere between 50 and 60 miles an hour on this fast descent. So you've got to have your wits about you. And we've talked before, when a rider gets tired, they start to make mistakes. And let's hope that that doesn't happen on this fast descent.
So Simon Richardson comes to the front for Sigma Sport. They're all riding, they're all taking their turn. They come to the climbs, they're all taking it easy. Back to the second group of Dan Fleeman, just kicking over their pedals. But at the end of the day, he's not eaten into this gap. Still over 5 minutes, as we believe. But at the end of the day, national hill climb champion, he is a mountain goat, but just leaving it too far.
He spends a lot of time training over in Mallorca, does Dan Fleeman, so he's a man who likes the warm weather. He likes to be in that sort of climate. You kind of sense that if he hadn't hung back so far earlier on, if he'd gone up the road and tried to go with some of the moves, and of course Jeremy Hunt's a former teammate of his at Cervelo test team, then he would have had a chance. Where's Ian Bibby? Is he still here or is he not? Dan Fleeman's gone it alone.
Yeah, Dan Fleeman just set a tempo on this climb. Bibby unable to follow at the moment, so the young rider from the Motorpoint Marshall's Pasta team has just drifted off the back. The thing is, there's two ways of riding a national championship. You either ride aggressively from the start and use up a lot of energy and try and hang on and finish it off, or you sit back, wait for everybody tiring, and you know, put your effort in towards the end. You either go both ways. These all riders have decided to go out early, risk it. Dan Fleeman decides sit back, save it for later, because it's going to come down to a war of attrition. I think he's made a huge mistake. If he had the legs earlier on to go here, I'd love to have seen you know, rally representing this front group, especially Dan Fleeman, to give him that opportunity. Fortunately, on his own now, Ian Bibby not with him. Dave Clark in no man's land. Andrew Fenn now dropped off from Dan, Dave Clark. So at the moment, we've only got five riders in this national championship list. As we go back to the fourth group on the road, Anthony.
So this is the fourth group on the road. We haven't caught up with them for a little while. And the man on the front there is Chris Froome of Team Sky. Tracking him, Rob Partridge. Remember him in the Premier calendar, winning the Rydell Grand Prix a couple of weeks ago. The former Welsh road race champion. Now these guys are riding well, but they've left it very, very late to try and come back up to Dan Fleeman and then the leading group. Good to see Chris Froome back on form. This man, of course, really was the man of last year's race. He was on the attack pretty much all day. He didn't let up all the time until the run into the finish when he was a little bit outwitted. But Partridge is looking very, very strong there in second place for the Endura Racing team, another domestically based professional.
Well, he's puffing and blowing a wee bit at the moment. It really suits Rob Partridge this race today. Unfortunately, he doesn't normally have the legs in a race like this very early on. He always comes good towards the finish. And good to see him in the mix, good to see him making an effort. And who knows, these three riders could collect a few riders in front of them and finish in the top 10 today. I don't think anybody's going to come anywhere near these five riders in front. As Peter Kenyon just eases up, eases the legs a wee bit. The strain in the body over the last few laps is starting to tell. And we're going to get into the business end where things are going to happen as soon as we get into the last couple of laps.
So the Cervelo test team car just came back up to the rear of the convoy here. And for those of you watching for the first time, and maybe you've switched over from the football and you'd rather be watching the cycling, these team cars have a spare bike for the rider on the top. The director sportif sits in there. He keeps an eye on the keeps an ear on the race radio. He's got extra bottles, he's got gels and food and everything else. And they now and then they'll just request from the commissars, the judges, can I go up and talk to my rider? A little bit difficult on these narrow roads to be able to do that, but they'll make sure that they keep their rider boosted up and morale as high as possible. And particularly when they're going through a difficult time, like Jeremy Hunt has been, they will do their utmost to keep him going. Just looking at what Jeremy's up to now, I think he's adjusting his shoes now. He's got hot feet.
Yeah, I think he'll be hot all over as we come down this slight descent at the moment. I don't think everybody really appreciates how hard this circuit is. You've got to remember, 120 odd riders in the start line today. Probably the best British Championship field we've ever had. And you know, the quality is really there. From lap one, Jeremy Hunt went off on his own, quickly joined by Thomas and Richardson. On lap three, Kenyon Kilstannard came across, and that's been it pretty much all day. We had a chasing group driven by David Miller. David Miller cracked a couple of laps ago, gone, and there's people spread all over Pendle at the moment. This race is all about these five riders. They've been out the front all day. The heat here is unrelentless. It's coming down. Everybody's enjoying themselves. This man here, Dan Fleeman, over 5 minutes down at the moment, on his own, riding for Rally. He's going to find it tough, but sixth place for Rally in the National Championships is a good result.
Well, this race is supported by the Northwest Development Agency. Have made sure they put on lots and lots of events in this area as part of their major event strategy. And the roads are nice and closed, which is nice and safe for the riders. But Partridge just trying to get that body going on this climb yet again as he tries to close things up just a little bit. But this group, they've got an awful lot to do to try and bring back any of the riders in front of them. This is Paul Esposti, who rides for a team called BCV. He's a rider with a lot of experience, this Welsh rider.
I used to ride with Paul a good few years ago, so that shows you how old he might be and how old I am. But Paul, a great rider, Welsh rider, great strength, and we've seen a few riders mature with age, talking about Jeremy Hunt in the Tour de France at 36 riding the Tour for the first time. So it's great to see some riders now coming out this chasing group, trying to go for it in the last few laps and trying to get a top 10 performance, because that's all they're going to be able to achieve today. The winners coming from this group are still not really started to see the real racing towards winning this race. As Peter Kenyon again stretches his body as we start coming in towards town, and we're going to be hitting three laps to go.
107 riders took the start. These are the five riders who have really set the race out, taken it to everybody else and left everybody else in their wake. In fact, many riders are probably sitting at the roadside having an ice cream, trying to drown their sorrows after training so hard for this National Road Race Championships. Geraint Thomas looking pretty cool, calm and composed as Peter Kenyon again sets the pace. Remember a couple of weeks ago on Alpe d'Huez when Alberto Contador was trying to attack the rest of his breakaway companions and win a stage at the top of Alpe d'Huez, those two young riders only lost 6 minutes to him, and they just rode to the top of it. They said it was a great experience. Peter Kenyon is constantly stretching his legs and his back. He's had a little bit of knee injury from time to time this year. He absolutely hammered the training camp at the beginning of the season, took him a little bit of time to recover, but he's certainly coming good now.
Well, he was the strongest in the championship last year, and can he pull the jersey on at just a tender age? He's sitting up, he's stretching his legs. I'm a wee bit unsure here. He's still young, experienced, inexperienced, and at the end of the day, you know, in these hot conditions, you have to keep drinking, you have to keep the nutrition up, the salt in your body, because at the end of the day, cramp can start to appear. And let's hope it's not, because he's a terrific talent, and we don't want to see anybody suffer. We've already seen David Miller suffer already for Garmin. These five riders all taking a turn. Three riders at the front. Did you notice, Anthony? All three of the Sky riders have got their zip just slightly down. But you look at Jeremy Hunt, fully unzipped, and Sigma Sports Simon Richardson zipped halfway down. So the two riders not in the Sky team, Richardson of Sigma Sport and Jeremy Hunt of Cervelo, really feeling the heat in this National Champs today.
I'm wondering whether then, everyone has talked about this Team Sky kit, the way it was designed, and when it was unveiled, everyone saw the front, the black, the turquoise and everything else, and then everyone kind of didn't realise it for when the team presentation happened. You turn round and it was white on the back with a thin blue line that they talk about. And they talked about the reason they did that, and they put white on the back of the jersey, particularly for the Tour de France, for days like this, when the sun is beating down on your back and you want reflection of that heat. And maybe that's why today it's paying off. They don't look as hot as the other two riders.
Well, this team is all about marginal gains, and I think today they've got the kit, you know, as you say, white on the back. The two other riders of Jeremy Hunt and Simon Richardson of Sigma Sport, both black jerseys, and that could be helping the Sky Riders today.
Peter Kenyon takes a bottle through the feed. Just take a little bit of time to relax here, Peter Kenyon, as he dodges round a pothole on the left, or not quite a pothole, but a drain cover on the left hand side, making sure that he doesn't have an impact puncture or anything else. Well, as we look here at the leader, Graham, I think, has found Stuart Kellett, who's he's going to have a quick chat to him.
Well, Stuart, we've got a record number of British entrants in the Tour de France this year. We've got huge crowds here at the National Championships, which is live on TV for the first time. Pretty good days for British cycling.
Fabulous for British cycling, fabulous for everyone who's come here today. I've had a couple of great days. I was at the National Sports Eve yesterday, testing out the countryside and the course today. It is a killer, but what a fantastic day for cycling.
All over the course we're seeing these banners for Skyride. Just tell us what that is.
Well, Skyride's about having fun on a bike. The partnership between British Cycling and Sky have come together to produce a mass participation cycling programme. This year we're in 10 cities and we're going to produce mass participation rides in the city centres. We're going to close the roads off to traffic, and you're going to be privileged to go around the city centre and feel what it's like to go on a bike with no traffic and have fun and see the city in a very different way. And to back those up, we've got lots of local rides. We've got over 500 local rides across those cities, led by qualified ride leaders. And it's really designed for people who are, you know, getting into cycling, maybe a bit apprehensive, not sure what to do about, you know, the gear and where to go. We've mapped out some great routes, and anyone of any ability can get involved in cycling this summer.
That's very good of you, but have you not got enough to do trying to run Team Sky and British Cycling, which are hugely successful and massive operations, I'm sure?
They are. We've got plenty to do, but we've got a lot of support now. We've got a big infrastructure behind us with support from Sport England and UK Sport as well. So we've got a good infrastructure, so we're ready to go. The good thing about working at both ends, both the elite level and the grassroots, is that you can inspire so many people when you've got the best of sport on TV, and, you know, the way we're projecting Team GB, the way that the pro team's going in Team Sky, it just makes you want to get on a bike. And we've got an answer, which is Skyride.
Participation levels really on the upsurge. Have you noticed that over the last couple of years?
Massively. I mean, cycling's really in a roll now, isn't it? And I think we've just got to seize the moment. You know, sports participation across different sports is going up and down. Cycling's really rocketing. And last year alone, we influenced 300,000 people to get on a bike, and we know that 100,000 of those are cycling at least once a week. So the program's working, and this year we're going to double the program again.
300,000 people on a bike. There can only be one national champion, though. I wonder who it'll be. Let's return back to the live pictures with Brian and Anthony.
Well, thanks, Graham. As we now see an attack from one of the riders from Team Sky, and Jeremy Hunt, who has been suffering, has immediately gone with this move.
Yeah, it's Geraint Thomas there. Just went on the attack. Jeremy Hunt just showing he's still got a bit of form left, still got some strength in the old legs. Kenyuk goes with him. Stannard's trying to come across at the moment, but the person we thought that had the strength to stay with these guys seems to be the Sigma Sport rider, Simon Richardson, just popping out the back at the moment.
Onto the climb, they've got three laps to go, and Jeremy Hunt's got his race face on. He's gritting his teeth, and he'll almost wear them away. He's having to do that so much. Richardson focused, just desperately trying to close the gap. Kenyuk now senses it's time for Team Sky to get rid of these riders, and Stannard's going to go. Now Jeremy Hunt's starting to suffer. He's managed to go with one move, and now the gap's starting to go, and it's Kenyuk who's doing all the damage here.
Well, what did we say, Anthony? I don't think there's any team in the history of the British Championships finished 1-2-3, and this is a possibility today, and all Stannard has to do is stay there. Kenyuk looking back. It's supposed to be an individual race, and it looks as if Kenyuk looks around, and Stannard just being a wee bit distance. Is he going to ease up? Doesn't look as if he is, and it looks as if we could have a tandem left at the front.
Well, we went down for that interview with Stuart Kellett about Skyride and about motivating everyone to get on their bikes with the aim of getting 1 million British people onto their bikes. Well, if this doesn't motivate you to ride a bike, I don't know what will. Geraint Thomas on the front, Kenyuk is going with him. Stannard is blowing up here. He's unable to go with the move of these two riders who've ridden through the Alps in the Criterium du Dauphiné together. In fact, they are pretty much inseparable when Geraint Thomas was in the green jersey. And now they are exploding this race all over these Pendle roads as we go up Barley Lane.
You're absolutely right. Geraint Thomas taking a leaf out Bradley Wiggins, such an ambassador for cycling in this country, coming from the track, the pursuit. Geraint Thomas set one of the fastest times in the world just last year, at the end of last year. Now coming into, he's, you know, at the Tour de France again, looking very fit, looking very thin. Then you get the rider at the front, just to give you an indication of the talent of young Kenyuk here. I think with about five laps to go, there was only three under 23s left in the entire field, and they're over 7 minutes down at the moment. Young Kenyuk is under 23, but he's not eligible because he's in a Pro Tour team, so he isn't in that competition. Just gives you an indication of where that young man is at the moment.
Also, you know, we're not just talking about a rider who is trying to go for a British Championship. As we look at Geraint Thomas with the sweat now starting to seep through the shoulders of this Sky Team jersey. But Peter Kenyuk, he's not even sweating, I tell you. It's pretty impressive here. Think of the World Championships last year. Mendrisio. Kenyuk was in all the moves all day, and he just missed out on getting the real performance that he wanted to get on the podium.
Yeah, again, he had the whole entourage from Nailaman there, his mum, his dad, the whole family, his brother, unfortunately for him and Mendrisio, he thought he was going for bronze medal. They had no race radios then, and it was very difficult. But I've just noticed, Anthony, Peter Kenyuk is riding a different jersey. He's got a bit of mesh down the side. Geraint Thomas, you can see some salt on his shoulder. This young man, is, we've said about talent the whole time, we've seen down, further down the climb, we've got Stannard on his own, we've got Hunt on his own, we've got Simon Richardson on his own. Peter Kenyuk looks to me in tremendous form at the moment, and what a young rider he is, picking slightly different jersey. Hopefully we'll be able to show that shot again of the mesh and down the side. That's keeping him very cool at the moment. It could go either way here.
Yeah, I wouldn't bank all your money here on Geraint Thomas taking this title, because Kenyuk looks cool, calm, collected, and Stannard, on the other hand, is feeling every single foot of this climb. The man who a couple of years ago was in a day-long breakaway in the Tour of Britain, and of course, he finished on the podium of the Tour of Britain a couple of years ago. He went away, he rode for some of the continental-based squads, he learnt his craft, he rode for the Lambra Credit Team, he rode for ISD, and then when the big team of the big British team of Team Sky came along, Stannard was picked because he can ride fast, he can ride all day, and he has exceptional power.
Well, you don't get offered a contract by two other Pro Tour teams last year. He chose to go with Sky, he chose British. Best choice, and you know, he is a real powerhouse. You need powerhouses in your team. He's trying to hold on for bronze medal. It'd be terrific if he was able to do that. I think he's going to get some fighting behind from Simon Richardson and Jeremy Hunt. I think the gold and the silver could be going to Team Sky with the two riders in front of Thomas and Kenyuk. But back, still in the action, Simon Richardson of Cyclosport sitting in fifth place at the moment.
If you look at that back pocket, he's got a gel just hanging out of it. He's back onto this descent. They go across the top, then they swing right over the cattle grids, set themselves up for that little climb, down another fast descent through back towards the finish. Interestingly, in preparation for today, I was talking to Ben Swift yesterday, who hasn't really featured in this race, and some of you watching who know Ben Swift may have expected him to, but he's had a bit of a back injury over the last few weeks, but slowly but surely he's coming back. And he said, when you get onto this stretch of road, it's surprising how windy it is. It's completely exposed in the forest of Boland, in this area, this fantastic area to go walking and mountain biking and riding like this. But he said it's really tough along here, and this is where the continental-based riders would make the difference. But here's your leaders. So as we look down on two Team Sky riders on the attack, they have 2.5 laps to go now. Geraint Thomas and Peter Kenyuk, they're setting themselves up for victory. Can they be caught? Will they stay away? We'll be back after this. Welcome back to the British National Road Race Championships. We are 2.5 laps now from the finish of this race, and it is a race that in the concluding stages is being absolutely dominated by the strength of Team Sky. Two riders in the lead, Geraint Thomas and Peter Kenyuk. Are these two riders who've ridden many races together this year for Team Sky, and now they're trying to hold off the rest of the chasers. Thomas on the front, Kenyuk second wheel.
Well, these two riders have looked the strongest as this group of five riders that went away with Hunt, Richardson, Kenyuk, Thomas and Stannard. Been away all day, as you see just behind Stannard trying to come back at the moment, and if they look behind, they'll see their teammate coming across in the less steeper part of this course today. And again, we're still looking at 1, 2, 3 for Sky.
Well, let's test your knowledge. When was the last time a Welsh rider won the National Road Race Championships?
Well, looking back in history, it was 2002, and Julian Wynne, who's here sitting in the team car of the Enduro Racing Team, won it in 2002. As we just look back at the moment, teamwork at its best. Thomas and Kenyuk waiting for Stannard. They know that the rest of the riders, Hunt and Simon Richardson, have been distanced on this descent. They're waiting for Stannard, so there's going to be three Sky riders of Thomas at the front, Kenyuk just behind, and Stannard setting the pace in this 2010 National Championship. So we are going to see a new winner this year, but still we don't know what country it's going to go to. It could go to Wales, could go to the Isle of Man, or it could go to England. You choose.
Well, let's see what happens as the riders disappear through the trees. Maybe Stannard will get back on this descent. He's a good descender. It's interesting that these riders, as they've grown up, have spent most of their time actually either living close together, racing together. Stannard and Thomas, based in Caranta in Italy most of the time as they work their way through the Olympic Academy. Kenyuk's been there as well. They know each other very, very well indeed. But look at this beautiful countryside. A fantastic area to hold the National Road Race Championships. As we look here at Thomas and Kenyuk glancing around to see whether Stannard actually comes back. This area, of course, dominated by Pendle Hill at 577 metres. It towers over this area and gives you some spectacular views. And the riders and fans who've come out here cheered on Team Sky and Endura Racing and Sigma Sports Specialised and Cervelo Test Team, all the riders, they've had a great time here. They have certainly produced a great atmosphere, even with a World Cup match on.
Yeah, with the spectators that have come here have shown a real set of strength of the Sky team here with Kenyuk on the right-hand side. Looking back in history, Anthony, the last rider from the Isle of Man to win this championship was the Pocket Rocket Steve Jockin way back in 1988. As we're looking back at Ian Stannard, just about to make contact with his two teammates in front.
Well, these magnificent closed roads as he heads down this descent, and it's pretty dark through the trees down here. But Stannard, slightly heavier than the other two, very fast indeed. He will tuck down. Normally what you find is the riders hit about 70 kilometres an hour and then they won't pedal anymore because they won't go much quicker by doing so. And Stannard, look at that, like a stone, dropping down to try and catch the leaders.
Well, it's a great setting here in the northwest of England, in Barley, Pendo area. Terrific. If you want to come here and ride your bike round this course in the next few weeks, by all means, try and come round it, do one lap, and maybe you can time what Rob Hales has done. Maybe you can try and beat him, because these guys have been flying round this lap in about 20 minutes. All three riders of Sky have now joined forces. So you've got Thomas, you've got Stannard, you've got Kenyuk all together. The sky is blue here. The sky is blue in the road at the moment.
The only thing I would do is make sure you put on a nice small gear so you can get up these climbs. Apart from that, have a wonderful time. Right, this is a group including the former national champion, the defending champion there, second wheel, Christian House of the Rafa Condor Sharp team. He's been in a chasing group all day, but Rafa Condor Sharp really have not been anywhere near the front all day today. Not the day for them.
Well, number one in his back, Christian House, the defending champion from last year, as you said, Anthony. Came into this championship with probably one of the best form of his life and really motivated to do well. Almost half a lap down now. It's been a disappointing day for Christian, but I'm pretty sure he'll bounce back in the next few races.
Well, he's very strong-willed, he's got a strong mind. I wonder whether the fact that Chris Newton, the Olympic medalist and of course former world champion, he was knocked off his bike by a car in the middle of the week, and I wonder whether the fact that Chris Newton hasn't been on top form today, because that will have shaken him, has reduced the firepower of the Rafa Condor Sharp team and really not made them as strong as we've seen them in the British Premier calendar.
Just look at this, Anthony. Rod Illingworth came up, just gave Ian Stannard a gel, told him he'd take it, and he's straight on the front. You think, after struggling up that climb, the other two riders of Thomas and Kenya would give him a rest on the back, but no, it's an individual championship. You have to take your turn at the front, and it's going to go down to the last two laps with three riders from Sky in this race for the championship.
Look at Kenya, he looks so strong on the front right now. I'm thinking back in the in history in terms of three riders riding together at the front of a, what to them is an incredibly important race. And the only one I can really think about was the Paris-Roubaix with the MAPE team, with Johan Museo and other riders like that. If you remember that as a cycling fan, this is a mirror image.
Even Ghent, not Ghent Wevelgem, Flesh Wallonne, when the Guy Weiss riders in my era done it with Argentine, absolutely phenomenal. What we're seeing here is a display of power. I mean, everybody knew, everybody came along, they wanted to see the Sky riders. A few riders wanted to see David Miller and Mark Cavendish, and it was great, they came along, especially Cavendish. This doesn't suit him, and for him to come along just shows his support for British cycling. Came along, showed his face, done a few laps, and is probably in the showers at the moment and having a cold shower preparing himself for the Tour de France. This, everybody came here to see Team Sky win it. This is one of the, don't get me wrong here, this is one of their major objectives for the year. They had to win this, and what a powerful way to do it.
Well, they're heading again towards the end of this lap, and this time round they will get two laps to go of this 12 kilometre circuit. The fans are all making their way into the finishing area to cheer these riders in, and it's a three up team time trial between the three of them. Kenneth goes to the front yet again for Team Sky. He's got such a fantastic pedalling style, looks so easy. Thomas in a slightly smaller gear, but you kind of sense that Kenya could get rid of them when he felt like it.
Well, it is going to be interesting over the last two laps here. It is an individual championship, we keep on saying that. Teamwork shouldn't really play a part in it. We've got three members of the same team, Sky, all with the same objective. I know Kenya really wants to win this. He really is passionate about winning his first elite championship. He wants to pull on that jersey, and nothing's going to stop him, and the only thing he's going to stop him is one of his teammates.
Well, I've said before in commentary here on Eurosport that Brad Wiggins has been quoted as saying that if he doesn't win the Tour de France, then the rider who's most likely to is the rider who's in this group, Peter Kenyon. As they take on another bottle, they're about 26 kilometres now from the finish. Of course, they can't feed within the last 20, so they have to make sure that they get as much drink on board as they possibly can for the last two laps.
We're just looking at these three riders. Stannard, what guts and determination would be make a great winner and wait a great jersey wearer of the national champs jersey. In second place, Kenya, one of the best young talents we've got in this country. What a great opportunity for him to showcase this national champs jersey. At the back, Geraint Thomas again. Last time a Welshman won it was 8 years ago. Julian Wynne, Dura Racing, Director Sportif today. Going to the Tour de France, it would be great for British cycling if he could show that jersey off. So all three of these riders would be a deserved winner of this national champs today. It's not all over, there's still two laps to go, and we're going to see some action. But I think we're going to see some action when it gets into the last lap.
Well, they're working well. They're sharing the pace making between them. They're starting to lap a few more riders. And the smiles will certainly be on the faces of Sky, who've invested so much on bringing this team to the roads. But it's not just about having a squad who ride like this. It's about getting people on their bikes. And that's why the 12 Sky rides that are taking place during this year are so important. And supported by, of course, some of the British cycling riders like Vicky Pendleton and Chris Hoy. There's even one in Southampton where I'm from. Right, we're heading now towards the finish line. This time round, these three riders are getting two laps of this course to go.
Well, the great crowd here is building in this finishing straight, and it's going to build all the way to the finish. You just see the big screen on the right-hand side. Everybody sitting in the sun here in Bali. Beautiful day, having pub lunches, having barbecues, having a few beers. But these three Sky riders, along with 104 other riders, have slogged away, entertained them pretty much all day. Don't forget the women's race this morning. What a great that was, what a deserved winner. And at the end of the day, it was a great race. We've seen another great race here. Again, another war of attrition, and it's going to go down to the last lap. The team car is there for Sky, which means the gap down to the next chaser must be just over 1 minute now.
Jeremy Hunt's looking at his bottle and thinking, please, there must be something more in here, I need some more drink. He's been the man of the race. He attacked at the top of this climb the first time round, which means that Jeremy Hunt has been on the attack now for pretty much the entire 13 laps. It hasn't really worked for him today. He's been left behind by the might of Team Sky, but he's given it the best possible go he could.
Well, he knows the medals have gone up the road. He didn't have the legs to go with them, so he just does the professional thing. All he has to do is just get round, get to the finish. He is going to the Tour de France next week. He's going to be flying the flag for Britain as well in the Cervelo testing.
So he'll line up in Rotterdam. He'll be looking after the interests, of course, of Tor Hushov and Carlos Sastre. He'll thrive in that. Hushov and him are great friends. And it's interesting, though, isn't it, that this British rider is going to try his utmost to make sure that Mark Cavendish in the HTC Columbia team doesn't come home with a green jersey, because he wants a Norwegian to win it.
Well, I don't think he wants a Norwegian to win it. At the end of the day, he's getting paid to do a job, and unfortunately, he's in a rival team with a rival person for the green jersey. It's going to be a great battle between Hushov and Cavendish for the jersey. You know, you need to tune in. Coming up on Thursday, we've got the team presentation early evening, being brought to you by Eurosport, and then again straight into the action this weekend. Back in this action today, three riders, still Team Sky, dominant force at the front of this race today.
And you'll be bringing us the team presentation on Thursday.
I will do, yes, and I'm going to look forward to that. But at the end of the day, this is talking about team presentations. This is going to be the team of today. We saw some strong performances by Sigma Sport, Simon Richardson, Jeremy Hunt, again strong performance there, a former winner at 36 riding his first Tour de France. Looking at the back here, Ian Stannard just starting to struggle up this climb. You just have to ride gentle, because they know if Stannard goes out the back here, we don't know where the chase group is. We see Simon Richardson just coming through the finish at the moment, so he's losing a lot of time. It's just starting to hurt all these riders. Jeremy Hunt is just in front of them, still in fourth place. But this moment in time, the best domestic rider we've got in this race, sitting in fifth place. Fantastic effort by him today.
As we look there at the car, Dave Brailsford, Team Sky was his brainchild, and now he is looking here as he watches three of the riders in the squad, and he's just chatting away to them, and actually they're just smiling and having a good time. He's just motivating them and trying to keep them going to the finish. But Brailsford must be smiling from ear to ear in that car.
It's a success. It's fantastic when we see this happening, and that's what everybody came here for. Everybody came here to Pendle to see a great race. We are seeing a great race. They are the strongest riders in the race. Great effort by Stannard at the back. No one really talked about Stannard too much. Everybody's talking about these two riders in front, Kenyon and Thomas. They're having a laugh at the moment. It's for anybody coming around here and doing one lap. You know, they are doing 15 laps today. It's going to be very tough. Dave Brailsford came up and talked to them. I hope that when it comes to the last lap, it's like every man for themselves, and they really, you know, they really fight for this national jersey.
I agree with you. It's got to be, as I think Mark Cavendish said at the start of the programme, man against man, to try and produce the best national champion. But look at the countryside in the backdrop there. You don't get much better than this for riding your bike. It's there's not much traffic out here.
I used to love riding in this area. There's been a lot of races in the past. You can go way back to Brian Cookson, president of British Cycling, organising the Tour de Lancashire, brilliant part of the world. You can just see it's great racing, great day for Team Sky. A lot of the riders behind will not have a chance to look at this scenery as the sweat drips across their eyes.
Stannard is certainly the rider who's suffering most in here, as the cars behind them support these three riders. We've enabled this to all happen. Madison and Fiat and other sponsors have brought this race together and made sure that we've been able to bring the national championships live on Eurosport for the first time. Just looking at Geraint Thomas, I'm a little bit concerned about how much he is now sweating, how much sweat is seeping through that jersey. It's very noticeable.
Yeah, but at the end of the day, a lot of these riders, some sweat more than others. I was a sweater. I used to show quite a wee bit of salt in my kit. But it just means that my cooler system was working top notch at the end of the day. And at the end of the day, these pictures that we're seeing at the moment is fantastic. Great power of strength with Sky and a great course. And, you know, what more can I say? Looking at these three riders of Stannard, Thomas and Kenyon, coming on to the last lap, I think at the end of the day, the team car's coming up alongside and say, guys, it is the national championship. Give respect to the jersey. With one lap to go, man oh man, as everybody's been saying all day, strongest man wins this race.
Beautiful countryside. Team Sky have cast their spell in one of the most famous areas for the Pendle Witches. You may remember that from your history lessons back in 1612. The trial of the Pendle Witches is one of the best documented in history. But it's a fantastic area, rich history, and these guys are showing how to win bike races against, of course, the best riders in Britain. The only rider who I think many fans were disappointed didn't take to the start line was Brad Wiggins, who's preparing for the Tour de France in a week's time. The only other rider really who didn't take to the start line, a former champion, Roger Hammond, who may well have done something on this course. But apart from that, everyone else is here.
Well, they're definitely in the top of the world here. Sky at the front of this race, and you know, sky's the limit for a lot of these riders, especially this man at the back, Peter Kenyon. What a talent. We keep on going on about it. You've got to remember that he won the under 23 crown last year. He is only 21. With five laps to go, there was only three other under 23 riders going for these medals in this race. It just goes to show you the calibre of this young man, and let's just hope, fingers crossed, he keeps developing and developing, because this rider can really do something. And I think for Team Sky, he has a huge potential when it comes to the Tour de France in 5-6 years' time.
It is incredible the way the Isle of Man have produced these riders. It all goes back to the academy programme that they started when they set up just some young riders. Here's Jeremy Hunt, let's just think back to him. He's the man of the race, really. He's desperately trying to hold on to his place, but that body must be screaming out in pain. Don't worry, Jeremy, top of this climb, and then you've got only one more time round it to go. But we think back really to the Isle of Man riders. They started off, they had a few kids being invited along every, I think it's every Tuesday or Wednesday night in the Isle of Man, and slowly but surely more riders got interested. A young rider called Mark Cavendish turned up, Johnny Bellis turned up, Peter Kenyon, Tim Kenyon, and now they've got some of the best riders in the world by motivating youngsters to get on their bikes.
Well, now we see Dave Clark just finishing, just coming across the finishing line there. He's got two laps to go again in no man's land. Going back to the Isle of Man, I actually was resident there for 9 years. I saw the start of it. It's a person called Dot Tilbury down at the National Centre, and it was a Tuesday night. They used to get kids, and it just grew and grew and grew, and it's great to see what you know, what's developed from there. As we see Simon Richardson just struggling again up this, he's got Jeremy Hunt in front of him. Terrific ride by him to go on the break all day today. Domestic rider in this Sigma Sport Specialised team, tremendous performance, and let's hope he can hang on and finish top five.
Well, he's looking pretty drawn now. He's just focusing on the road ahead, and he just wants to feel the relief of going over the top of this climb. You can feel every pedal stroke. Jeremy Hunt speeding up a little bit. This has been an incredible day out on the road as he goes past the motorbike. Next week he'll be in the Tour de France, and he'll be going up and down mountains when we get to about stage 8, I think it is, in the Tour de France. So he's certainly, this race is going to set him up for the first few days of the Tour.
It just goes to show he's Palmer. As if he stays where he is at the moment, he's going to finish fourth, just outside the medals. But terrific, I think, he's got one of the best palmarises in the, you know, the national championships over the years. Stannard Thomas Kenyon, 13, 12, 15, three riders from Sky trying to gain gold, silver and bronze in the 2010 championships here in Barley in the northwest.
Stannard now onto the front, big frame of this rider. Again, the zip slightly down as they head up here, and there's Andrew Fenn, I think, going across the line. So he's still there, and he's still riding round in the top 10 riders. This under 23 rider from the 100% Me squad, which is the Olympic Academy team, who are based over in Italy.
Well, he's another good prospect that the 100% the Academy team have. He a former winner of the Junior Paris-Roubaix, so great talent. Just happens to be Scottish, not biased there. But yeah, a great talent, and we'll hopefully see a lot of him in the future. We've not seen anything of Dan Fleeman at the moment. Three riders from Sky at the moment. You've got Stannard, you've got Kenyok, you've got Thomas. That's the three riders you've got in the front picture at the moment. Just behind, you've got Jeremy Hunt. Behind Jeremy Hunt, you've got Simon Richardson. Behind there, you should have, we've not seen him yet, possibly Dan Fleeman of Raleigh on his own. Then we've got Dave Clark in his own, and then Andrew Fenn in his own. So all these riders have said this is going to be man oh man. Never told Sky, because they've got three, right? But everybody else is man oh man oh man.
They did not play to the same game that everyone else did. They went out, they used that leading group as a springboard to set this trio of riders up to go for the victory. We're around about 1.5 laps to go to the finish of the British National Road Race Championships. If you've just turned on, this is an incredibly tough bike race. 15 laps of a 12-kilometre circuit with, as David Miller said, more climbing than some stages of the Tour de France in the mountains. It has been a wearing down process. Jeremy Hunt of the Cervelo test team took the race to everybody else. He was joined by the Team Sky riders, who you can see here going down the descent, and Simon Richardson. But it's now the three riders from Team Sky who are setting themselves up to try and win the title that everybody in Great Britain wants.
Well, this is a group just coming up to finish with two laps to go. Partridge at the back, Poste, a Welsh rider just in second place, and Froome, a rider who was up there in the national champs last year and unfortunately never wasn't able to win that jersey. But three riders still looking for a top 10 performance here.
Yep, he was fourth last year, Chris Froome. A little bit disappointed not to have been selected for the Tour de France, but he's a rider who's had a little bit of a struggle this year with injury. Right, they're going to head towards the line. They're a long, long way down now, but they're two laps to go.
I'm just wondering where Simon Richardson is as well.
Yeah, good effort here by some of the domestic riders. We've got a few in front, back up to the front of this race. And again, it's Ken, you've set the pace at the front for Sky. And again, at the back here, we've got Stannard just putting his head down, trying to stay on there. At the end of the day, for Sky to finish 1-2-3 here, they have to keep Stannard with them as long as possible. If they go into this final lap with 2 minutes, then Stannard, by the looks of it, will have enough advantage to take that bronze medal. The two riders in front of Kenyok and Thomas look by far the strongest. When we hit this finishing line, I think we're going to see some action here between this duo in front.
Stannard just gets dropped on that little kick up before this fast, fast descent. He's using his skills in descending to come back to the leaders. Can he do it? That's the question. Those two riders at the front, Kenyok and Geraint Thomas, on the little risers, are just leaving him behind. So this is the state of play. Kenyok and Thomas, followed by Stannard, followed by Jeremy Hunt, Simon Richardson, Dave Clark, Andrew Fenn, the group of Rob Partridge, Paul Esposti. We just need to work out where they are. Fleeman, of course, Dan Fleeman is somewhere in the group, but we're not sure where he is out on the road. We haven't caught a glimpse. Suddenly, though, Ian Stannard, by the looks of things, has caught Kenyok and Thomas and immediately jumped past them.
Yeah, well, he was coming up at speed, as you keep on saying, he is the heaviest of the three. Came down this descent and he wanted to carry that momentum. both Thomas and Kenya decided that just ride gently down the descent. Stannard came up to him straight past. They know they still have to push on a wee bit. As I said, they have to have at least about 2 minutes when they cross the finishing line, because then the action will start. I think it'll be man against man in this final lap. No holes barred. They'll fight it out and respect this national champs today.
That was an interesting little move by Ian Stannard. We got used to him last year being in the luminous colours of ISD Nehru, but happy now to be in a British team as he sets the pace on the front. Happier, I think, setting a pace that his legs are comfortable with.
Well, sometimes that's the case. You ride at the front, you ride your tempo, and he's just flicking his elbow, let the other riders want to come back. Kenya, for me, is the danger man here. We're going to hit the finishing line. Straight after the finishing line comes that climb. Kenya, for me, is going to go on the attack.
Garrett Thomas on the front there. He said to me that after Dauphiné and at the beginning of this week, he had a little bit of a head cold. He was a bit concerned that maybe that was going to affect his form today. But there's no doubt at all it hasn't even touched him. So Thomas recovering from that head cold at the beginning of the week, and now he's in the trio at the front of this race. Kenyuk again at the front. Great suntan, he'll have topped it up today.
Well, that's what you don't want, is any cold, any ill feeling or anything like that at all going into the National Championships today, and especially the Tour de France coming up next week.
As we look down here on the three leaders, Kenyuk sneaked into the third position. So they're going to set themselves up and head towards the finish line. They will get the bell, and for all these riders, that's going to be a very welcome sound indeed.
Well, Kenyuk, just looking to me, I've done a lot of commentaries, I've watched a lot of races. To me, he's looking like the man when it comes to this climb. He's going to have a go. He really wants this Nash Champs jersey. He is totally focused. At the end of the day, he's got two other teammates round about him, and he really wants to take this title, because he doesn't, I think there's about 20 or 30 over from Nylaman. The whole entourage has come over to watch him, and he wants to deliver, not just for himself, but for all his support that he's had over the years to Nylaman.
Well, they're all there last night in the hotel, getting themselves set up for what they hoped was going to be the day. I remember them last year in Mendrisio. The whole entourage there, they all had t-shirts on, they were desperately wanted him to get on the podium. He didn't quite make it, but certainly the Peter Kenyuk fan club is larger than anyone's in Team Sky right now.
It's sometimes not a bad thing just to miss out. I said over the years, a lot of the talent comes from people like under 23 riders just missing out on the podium, just missing out on the medals. They're the riders that seem to go further, because if you can set success at a very early age, sometimes it can go to your head. So he's got his mum and dad, keeps his feet on the ground, and we keep on saying it, he's got a fantastic future ahead of him.
So as we look down on the three leaders, of course the sport in the UK is governed by British Cycling, and their programmes make sure that this racing actually happens on the roads across Great Britain all the time. And Graham's about to catch up with the competitions director, Johnny Clay.
Yes, Johnny Clay of British Cycling is here with me at the moment. Johnny, when you look around at the moment, I suppose you're wondering if British Cycling has ever had it so good.
Isn't it looking fantastic? I mean, quite clearly the weather's helped today, but the organisation of the bike race has been superb, the venue superb, and what's really exciting for us is to see those young aspiring bike riders now riding for Team Sky, just running away with the bike race, true superstars of the future, we'd like to think.
People here, I suppose, have got used to watching top level cycling live on television. It's always coming from France or from Italy or from Spain, but it's amazing now to have it coming from Pendle in Lancashire.
Well, it is. It's on purpose. You know, it takes some time. You have to build up over a period of time. But cycling in this country continues to grow from strength to strength. The television, the production, and the broadcast of domestic bike racing is something that we're slowly beginning to build. The fact that we're live here today is a reflection of that building aspects, and the fact that now the riders are of world class on the road. They're not just great track riders anymore. They're great road riders as well.
world class on the road. How long do you think it'll be before we get a British winner of one of the Grand Tours?
I say always hard to guess such things, but clearly, you know, with Bradley Wiggins' performance last year, Team Sky's aspirations. Let's not forget, there's lots of other great British cyclists on other continental teams as well. So we're in a very strong position. So I guess we're all avid fans, and we hope they continue to progress as they have been doing recently.
Well, Johnny, the future is very bright. The immediate future here of cycling is very exciting because things are really hotting up now. Let's go back to the live commentary with Brian and Anthony.
Well, thanks, Graham. Great to hear all about what British cycling is doing, not just to leave the sport as it is, but to increase its popularity and to get more riders involved, not just in riding their bikes, but in maybe producing more medalists like the Lizzie Armisteads and the Vicky Pendletons, the Nicole Cooks, the Geraint Thomases, the Brad Wiggins. The list goes on and on and on. Right, we're heading now towards the final lap as we look down there at those chain rings, or we were just looking at the chain rings of Geraint Thomas, those oval rings. It is now going to be the bell. One lap to go of 12 kilometres and this national title will be decided. The sun is shining. Who's it going to be shining on first when we get round to the finish line in 12 kilometres time?
You can just feel the goose pimples in the back of all these three riders' necks as they know one of these riders are going to pull on the national champs jersey. They're just starting to look at each other. There's still one lap to go, still this climb. They're going to start attacking each other on the hardest part of this climb coming up. Kenyuk at the front, Stannard in the middle, Thomas at the back. Thomas, to me, a lot of salt on his jersey at the moment. He has suffered from a bit of a cold, but he's going to give everything within his possibilities to take this title. But you just saw a bit of a move to the side by Kenyuk. He wants to get this last position. We're going to go round this corner. Kenyuk's going to go on the attack.
Stannard knows that he needs to try and set a pace up this climb that these two riders can't go with, because otherwise he will be dropped. You can hear the gears being clicked through. They've got these electronic gears on this Team Sky bikes that are just so incredibly responsive. Just touch a little button, they change gear immediately, and it's so slick.
Well, road racing in the UK has been a wee bit of a thorn in the side as far as performances go. We've cracked it on the track. You know, we're doing well in a lot of the other disciplines. Women's racing is looking fantastic, got a bright future. I think British road racing has turned a corner. We've got loads of races on TV now. The premier calendars the British Cycling produced and put on to Eurosport. Now we're seeing the first live coverage of the national championships. I wish this was my day, way back in the early 90s, and I could get all this. The future is bright for these young stars, and let's support them. Let's get behind them. This is a true performance by Team Sky today. Let's get behind them and let's push road cycling forward in the UK.
As we go back here to Jeremy Hunt, who will have one lap of this course to go as well for the Cervelo test team. A team that was set up and built around Carlos Astra. Now we've got an attack at the front, so who's going to go first? I don't think it's going to be Stannard who's going to be there. It will be, I would have thought, Kenyuk and Thomas.
Yeah, Kenyuk is the rider at the front, the smaller rider of the two, went on the attack as we expected. Thomas following. He knows that he's up against a tough young rider here. Kenyuk needs to flick his elbow, get Thomas to the front and try again. He's got plenty of time, but this is going to be man on man all the way to the finish. I still can't call it. Kenyuk is going to go and go and go, but you've got to remember that Geraint Thomas is a very experienced rider. He'll use all his experience to try and beat the younger man.
Look at this. Peter Kenyuk grits his teeth and now accelerates really hard up the climb. He looks around. He knows that Stannard's gone, but they need a little bit more by the top of this climb, because Stannard will, as we've been saying, descend quicker and come back to these riders. Thomas is not going to go through here. He knows that Kenyuk is the better climber. Look at this, an incredible performance from these two young riders going past all the fans at the side of the road. So Kenyuk's tried twice, He's got rid of Stannard. Can he get rid of the Olympic gold medalist Geraint Thomas? Here he goes again. Injects just a little bit more. Licks his lips almost and says, here we go now, Geraint. See if you can stay with this one.
Well, looking at the charts, as David Brailsford come up just a lap before then, he must have said to these guys, look, there's the British Championships, there's 3 years here, no teamwork now, onto the last lap, man against man, we're going to get the strongest rider in this race when he win it. Kenya, to me, looks the strongest in the climb, but we saw this morning that Nicole Cook was one of the strongest. She went and went and went, just never quite had it towards the end. Kenya is dragging Thomas away with him. He needs to get rid of him. I couldn't pick between the two come to a sprint finish, especially after a hard course like this of 15 laps. To me, Stannard is gone. He has to try and hold on to the bronze medal as we start to pick up and lap a few more riders.
Well, they've lapped these riders, so think about that. It's 12 kilometres, this circuit, which is 7 miles or so. That's how fast these Team Sky riders at Pro Tour level are going round this course. Magnificent to have the British Championships live on Eurosport. Looking down at the two leaders as Jeremy Hunt goes through the heads through towards the finish line, and he will have one lap to go.
Well, Jeremy Hunt still hanging in there. He was the first to attack. Just noticed that the two riders in front, Sky riders, have just passed, just at the bottom of the picture, one of the riders from the academy, the 100% me team. That's where the rider at the front, number 15, was last year. Gives you an indication where he's coming. They're talking to each other at the moment. He wants Thomas to come through. He does come through. Kenyuk is going to get a wee bit of a respite as they pass some of these supporters on the left hand side.
I made that gap back to Jeremy Hunt around about 4 minutes. He's going backwards very quickly, and let's hope he can hold on to his place, because steadily he's going to start to get caught by the chasers, and he deserves to finish where he's been all day. Stannard urging that body towards the top of the climb. He'll be very pleased he doesn't have to ride up it anymore. As we go back to Simon Richardson, who's heading now to get the bell, and Richardson is going to be somewhere around about 5.5 minutes behind those two leaders. But very well done, Simon Richardson. It's been a great performance. Maybe a couple of laps too long for him on this course against Pro Tour level riders. The gap 5:40.
Well, it makes a huge difference riding these Pro Tour events in Europe and riding Premier Calendar events. Hopefully, with this performance today, who knows? Somebody might be watching, and he could get signed up with a better team. That I'm not saying Sigma Sport are a bad team at the moment, but I think for Simon Richardson, he needs that chance. He needs that chance to ride the top races in Europe to give him that opportunity. Looks to me as if he's got the strength to be able to do that, and it's been fantastic that he's been able to do what he's doing with Sigma Sport Specialized today. Great effort. First domestic rider at this moment, lying in fifth position. Hopefully he'll maintain that. But Thomas and Kenya, bit of a truce at the moment, and hopefully we're going to see some more attacking if you get into the final few kilometres.
So as they make their way up this little rise for the final time, the two leaders in the British Championships, Peter Kenyuk, Geraint Thomas of Team Sky. Join us in a moment to find out who takes the jersey. We're into the final few kilometres now of the British Road Race Championships as we look down on the two riders who have dominated this race over the last few laps of this treacherous 12-kilometre circuit. We're taking a look here at Dave Clark and Dan Fleeman, who are around about 8 minutes down on the leading duo of riders. So Clark in the blue, Fleeman in the white colours, and I make it that they are the 7th and 8th riders on the road.
You would be correct. Fleeman, we didn't know where he was. He was drifting backwards at the moment. Clark actually coming up to him. But what we've got in our picture is two very talented bike riders. One from Wales on the left-hand side, Geraint Thomas. One from Niall Aman on the right-hand side. the one on the left-hand side, the Welsh rider, wins this. It will make history for Wales. 8 years since the last rider from Wales won the national championship. 22 years for the rider from the Isle of Man who won this national championship. Rider in third place at the moment, Ian Stannard. He's been like a yo-yo over the last two laps, coming back, getting dropped, coming back. Looks as if he's safely secured the bronze medal at the moment in time, barring he doesn't completely blow. Jeremy Hunt just going to be through the motions, being a professional about it all, is going to finish this race off. Another good performance today. This championship is going to be remembered for one of these riders. Yeah.
So we think about the rest of this course. They've gone up over Barley Lane, the climb that takes us up to 1,000 feet. Then we turn right down Black Moss Road, through Wheatheed Lane, down towards Blacko, turn right onto Blacko Bar Road, down that descent, through towards the finish on Barley Road. So there's only a couple of little places where the young rider at the front, Peter Kenyon, can actually try and springboard a victory. Interesting, it's a little bit windy now for these two riders. The temperature's dropping slightly. It's a bit more windy, but Kenyon manages to get Thomas to go to the front.
Won the longest and hardest climb of this race today. Kenyon went on the attack. Geraint Thomas follows. Geraint Thomas, as we see Ian Bibby of Motorpoint, just he's decided it's enough. Two laps, you know, onto the last lap, he just didn't have enough. He was with Dan Cleven, let's not forget, another talent, but again, one of the domestic riders, great future ahead of him, he just wasn't able to go.
Well, maybe the feast of criteriums that he's had over the last few weeks hasn't quite paid off for him. These longer races are really tough. Stannard in third place. The two riders in front of him here, I think, are riders who are about to be lapped.
Yeah, there's a few riders regrouping at the back of this field. The two riders in front of Geraint Thomas, but this is Stannard just passing two lap riders that have just been lapped.
Interestingly, they've just lapped
young Kenyon,
Tim Kenyon. So maybe next year he'll have got himself up to the level of Pete Kenyon, if that's at all possible.
Well, I'd like to hear what Tim said to Peter on the way by on that climb. Make sure you win, big brother. But it's going to be very difficult. You've got Geraint Thomas, one of the fastest riders in the world, over 4 kilometres. That's the rider on the left, number 12. And we've seen he held the points jersey in the criterium. De Dauphiné on the right, I would say on paper, one of between the two of them, a very good fast finisher. But over this grueling course, as David Miller says, like a Tour de France mountain stage. So it doesn't come down to who's the fastest sprinter, it's who's got enough left in the tank to be able to deliver at the speed at the finish.
Well, I said to Geraint Thomas yesterday that he surprised us when he got that third place in the second day on the Dauphiné and the stage won by Bowl of Lamprey. He then went for all the sprints, was still there at the finish, nearly took the green jersey, and he just kind of smiled and said, well, I'm feeling quite good now. As we go down towards the descent, it's going to be interesting tactics on the run-in. Who's going to be the first rider to make the move, or are they going to wait for the final 1 kilometre run-in to the finish?
Well, looking at the last time up the climb, Kenyon really forced it. Thomas couldn't go through, and I think they had a wee chat with each other as we went over the top. For me, it's looking as if it's going to come down to a sprint between the two of them. We might see some track stands, both of them very good riders on the track, but it's going to come down to man against man, strongest rider wins. Who's got the most energy left in the legs to deliver in the final few hundred metres of this race today?
Geraint Thomas is one of the fastest bike riders on the track in the world. So he does know that given the right day, with the right legs and the right tactics, he can win this. Pete Kenyon just had another chat to him. I wonder whether, actually, because they've ridden so often together, and he's a nice guy, he just said good luck. Maybe something like that. May the best man win.
Well, I'm not a lip reader, and it's very difficult. You are talking about one of the most prestigious jerseys in Great Britain at the moment, the national champs, with the red, white and blue stripes right across it. We've seen it this morning, given to Emma Pooley, well deserved. We're going to see another well deserved elite men's champion here today. Let's not forget the under 23 competition, and we're talking about riders that are probably the best under 23. It was over 10 minutes at this moment in time. For me, Geraint Thomas had to lead this out. When he leads it out, he's got the speed, he's got the stamina to be able to deliver a strong finish. Kenya has to push his body to try and get round Geraint Thomas, but for me, Geraint needs to lead out the sprint.
So it hasn't been a day for the defending champion Christian House, but this jersey, as we look here at the next group on the road, Paul Esposti, good ride from him. They're a long, long way down. They're going to be 14 minutes down, in fact 15 minutes down. But this jersey has been worn by David Miller, who will ride the Tour de France, by Russell Downing, now of Team Sky, by Roger Hammond of the Cervelo Test Team, by the man sitting next to me, Brian Smith, who's worn it twice, but riders such as Robert Miller, Malcolm Elliott, Sean Yates, some of the riders who have made their name not just at British level, but at world level, in Tour de France's, World Championships, Olympic Games. It means more than ever anyone can imagine, as Kenyatta again stretches his back.
Well, we've seen a great race today. You know, we did think it was going to come down to very few riders are going to finish this race. Terrific course, beautiful course, very hard course, and it just goes to show you that the strongest riders have come to the front. They've come to the front in the first lap. Let's not forget, Hunt went on the attack, Thomas Richardson followed, Kenyon and Stannard went after them, and nobody's really got near them. The best place that after that was probably what David Miller got within 2 minutes of him. Crack, blew up, now out the race. So we're down to two riders. Rider on the right hand side, a young rider, 21-year-old from Nail of Man, Kenya, here with his whole entourage from Nail of Man supporting him. Just behind Geraint Thomas, who is really matured. Remember talking to him when he rode the Tour de France for the first time, and he was like a fish out of water, really mature. This rider here has to be one of the riders of this championship, really putting on a strong home performance today, and he deserves this bronze medal. But who's going to take the gold? We'll have to wait and see.
180 kilometres, over 5 hours of racing. How tough is it to win a British champion's jersey in the world of cycling? That's what you have to do. And you have to race around here up some of these pretty fearsome climbs. If you went just out here on your bike and rode, you'd find it exceptionally tough. But these two riders now are heading towards the finish.
Well, we're getting close to 1 kilometre to go. Geraint Thomas at the front here, Kenyuk just in behind here, and one of these riders is going to wake up in the morning and they're going to look at themselves in the mirror and be so proud that they've got this national champs jersey sitting next to them on the bedside.
Kenyuk goes to the front. It's this little rise. They're going to go up towards the feed station now. Up at the feed station they've had during the race, because you can't feed now, it's too late. Up this little rise, but of course, we thought Emma Pooley would use as her springboard for victory. She didn't do that, she went on the flat. So we would expect Peter Kenyuk to use this as a springboard, because he is a better climber, but he hasn't. Is he going to use the same tactic as Emma Pooley? He moves over to the left-hand side. Thomas isn't going to go through at all now.
No, he's going to sit back. He knows probably Peter Kenyon. They know each other very well. You know, they train with each other, they race with each other. They know each other pretty much inside out. Geraint will know that the rider in front, Peter Kenyon, is very quick when it comes to the finish. He won't want to lead out. He's using his maturity. It's anyone's race at the moment, and it's going to be over in a matter of about 500 metres.
The Olympic champion in second place clicks through the gears. Kenyon, cool, calm, collected, just looks around, glances through the cars to see if there's anyone else there. He knows there isn't. Thomas looks to see whether there is any sign of cracking on Kenyuk's face, and the answer is a defiant no. The gap is 1 minute 20 seconds back to Ian Stannard, so they have some time.
Yeah, they have some time, but the road is running out, and they're going to start the sprint very, very quickly here. Geraint takes a bottle. Takes a drink from his bottle, the last drink he's going to have. This is going to be really tough contest. Who's going to win the championship 2010?
Geraint Thomas just kind of looked at, he almost built himself up there. I'm surprised he's still got his bottle on. In fact, I think both of them have got bottles on their bikes. They'd normally throw them off just to reduce any possible extra weight on that bike. But Thomas is track riding now, just hanging back a little bit, waiting for the jump of Peter Kenyuk, who's had to ride all the way through this last kilometre on the front. As they enter the trees, they will start to open the sprint up. Kenyuk now moves across to the other side of the road. Thomas tracks him. They're heading towards the finish. Who's going to open the sprint up first? No, still now they haven't done. As Kenyuk still looks around and sees that Thomas has not gone to anywhere, was close to an attack. Thomas tracking him as he does on the wooden boards of Manchester and Beijing and everywhere else. They're coming towards the last few corners and still the sprint hasn't happened. Who's going to win this one? They can see the finish line. Thomas is going to go on the left hand side. Kenyuk is going to try and match him. They are absolutely flying now towards the finish. Who's going to take the title? It looks to me like it's going to be a win for Thomas. Geraint Thomas takes the title. Peter Kenyuk takes second place. It must have been around about half a wheel, maybe a wheel between the two of them, but the track speed of the Olympic champion Geraint Thomas was enough to take the victory. Well, back now to Ian Stannard, quietly riding in. There's Geraint Thomas. Peter Kenyuk's going to be disappointed, but it's a great performance from him. Thomas will take the British champion's jersey to the start line of the Tour de France.
Well, that was a great hotly contested sprint there. For me, it was very difficult, but I think we're going to listen to Graham, who's with the winner now.
Well, let's go to Graham, who's with the winner of the 2010 British Championship, Geraint Thomas.
Geraint Thomas, many congratulations. When did you think you had that in the bag?
Not until 10 metres to go. obviously, Pete's going really strong in the climbs, and with a lap to go, I knew I just had to watch him. Because I'll take my hat off to him, he was flying. I was really worried about him, to be honest, and I just knew I just had to follow him. And, you know, I played it a bit. You know, I didn't roll through, and you know, but you know, that's bike racing. And, you know, Dave came up to us in the car, said that he's happy, got top three, and race it between yourselves, you know, and that's what happened.
I would imagine he's more than happy. I'd imagine he's ecstatic. 1, 2, and 3 in the British Nationals. That must have been what you dreamed about last night.
Yeah, definitely. I never thought that would happen, and the way the race went as well, you know, it was a strange race. And obviously, Jez went up there. I went across, and. Yeah, we just rode it really well, you know, we paced it nicely and just held the bunch at sort of a minute and a half, 2 minutes, and then then they sat up, and you know, it's just a weird race, the Nationals, and it's just something you got to take by the scruff of the neck, you know, and get stuck in, and that's what we did. So.
First time being British National Champion, you certainly didn't do it the easy way. Tell me about the course and the heat and the entire conditions.
Yeah, I was definitely feeling that, to be honest. I felt really good, and then towards the end I just started feeling my legs go a bit and a bit crampy, so but I had to just bluff my way through, and like I said, that last lap was really on, and I was really worried about that kid, and you know, he's going to win it for sure in the next few years.
Just finally, Geraint, the British National Champion jersey is going to appear in the Tour de France for the first time since 1992. That's going to be a great honour for you next week.
Great honour, you know, just riding the Tour with Sky and such a great team anyway, and then to have that representing Great Britain on the back on my jersey, you know, it's great.
Many congratulations,
Cheers,
Geraint.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Well, thanks, Graham. A very happy Geraint Thomas.
Yeah, very happy. Could have went either way there. We might see the sprint again. Kenyuk propped on the front. Maybe showing a wee bit of immaturity there. But look at the difference in the size of the gear. Geraint just in a quicker gear, smaller gear, punching the pedals round there. Kenyuk just gritting that teeth. I think slightly overgeared at the moment. And we did say it would come down to the final few metres and who really had the strength left in their legs. Geraint just having enough, and it was only a matter of what, half a wheel?
I think it was about half a wheel. You've called that perfectly, Brian. He's just slightly overgeared at the end. Just couldn't dive round him, but he got close. Geraint Thomas third in 2006 this time. You understand that the commissaire he is the champion. He will take the jersey. Well, of course, we're going to wait for the other riders to roll in, and we'll get the podium presentation where that white jersey with the blue and red band round the middle is presented to Geraint Thomas. And then his team sponsors are going to have to work on a jersey to get one ready for Rotterdam on Saturday.
Well, I think that all must be happening now from the man from Adidas is here with us in Bali, so he'll be working on it as we speak. But I think he probably knew about that with about two laps to go, so he's obviously got the design, everything ready already.
He'll be drawing it already and trying to get everything sorted out for Team Sky to head to Rotterdam. They're going to have a very busy week, of course, the build-up to the biggest bike race in the world, which will be here on Eurosport. The riders have to get there on Wednesday. They go through all their medical checks and everything else, and then the scale of the Tour de France will hit some of the riders in that squad who've never ridden it before.
What a race, you absolutely fantastic. Who could
not only the riders have made this championship 2010 totally you know, terrific race. These people here standing outside the road have made the atmosphere. The atmosphere in the finishing area is, you know, it's like electric, and I know I've been there twice, and you know, Geraint is going to stand on that podium. He's going to take the jersey for the first time, pull it on. It's not really going to sink in. It's when you wake up tomorrow morning and you look in the mirror and you realise, I'm British champion. And he's right saying Kenya, I think, was the strongest of the riders. At the end of the day, Geraint was there as well a few years ago, learned his craft, now matured, and was able to deliver that maturity to help him win this year's championship.
Everybody's been very supportive. Well, there's a jersey from the Cycle Sport Pendle. There's been some youngsters wearing that orange jersey during the weekend. I've seen very many of them, and I hope it's motivated them to carry on riding their bikes in this stunning area. I must admit, I have thoroughly enjoyed being here. It's so picturesque, it's been boiling hot, and you don't get much better than that. And these youngsters, maybe she's been motivated by Emma Pooley and Lizzie Armistead's ride with Nicole Cook earlier on today, and maybe the young guys have been motivated by Geraint Thomas and Peter Kenyon. But everyone now is heading towards the podium presentation. They want to see Geraint Thomas pull on that jersey, and then I know that already they are saying that the amount of people travelling to the start of the Tour de France, the first couple of days, Rotterdam and Brussels, is unprecedented. It's going to be more Brits over there than there are Dutch and Belgians.
Also available. So the standing's staying open, as I say, after the event. And if you'd like to get down there and get a souvenir, then
it's got its pink lead on. I'm wondering if that's a Rafa supporter.
With the worst talk of getting the first three riders.
So we're waiting for the podium presentation. We think back over this race, and of course Jeremy Hunt of Cervelo Test Team and Ian Stannard, Simon Richardson haven't crossed the line yet. They're a few minutes down. Jeremy Hunt was, 4 minutes and 40 odd seconds down. So look there at a couple of the Rafa Condor Sharp riders. They've had the British Champions jersey in their squad all year, and John Herity was on Twitter the other night and he said, you know, it's been great to have the British champion in your team all season. They weren't going to go down without a fight. It just wasn't their day.
I don't think it was a lot of riders day. Everybody knew this was probably one of the toughest courses in quite a lot of years. I can only think back to maybe one of the years when I won it in Isle of Man. It was a really tough course. That kind of suited me. But horses for courses, and you know, with the strongest team in Sky has come out here in dominant force and got gold, silver and bronze. We have been told that Jeremy Hunt has finished in fourth place, but coming up, first domestic rider to finish in fourth place, Simon Richardson from Cycling Sports Specialised.
We just caught a glimpse there of Jeremy Hunt crossing the line for the Cervelo Test Team. We haven't seen Ian Stannard cross the line, but he's in third. And Simon Richardson crosses the line now for Sigma Sport Specialised. And putting a mark for the riders who have had a feast of British Premier Calendar races this season. Of course, the next one will be up in Beverley in Yorkshire, coming in a couple of weeks' time. but he couldn't get off his bike quick enough. Right, we're going to the podium now. Fast move from Ian Stannard to get off the bike. Stannard takes the bronze medal in the British Road Race Championships for Team Sky. A great season for this rider. Third in the Kern of Brussels Kern. He was third in the Tour of Britain in 2008. But certainly a great performance in this National Championships, particularly on such a hilly course. Well, the silver medalist is the man from the Isle of Man, a talented young bike rider who Brad Wiggins says has got an incredibly bright future. Second in 2008, third in 2009, and of course he's been the under 23 champion silver medalist today. He's looking around to see which side of the podium they would like him to stand on. There we go. Okay, we're going to move on now to the winner. Very well deserved. Let's see the winner of the British Championship step onto the podium. He was third in 2006. Geraint Thomas of Team Sky is the British champion, and he will wear that, as we've said, for 3 weeks in the Tour de France. We think back, we mention it in commentary, he was the youngest rider in the Tour de France when he made his debut. But Brian, how's he going to feel when he pulls that jersey on? There he is.
I still think when you win your first title, I'm quite fortunate to win it twice, that you're still a wee bit dazed and you really need to take it in. But what a terrific performance here by all three of the Sky team, and well deserved by Geraint Thomas.
So G, or Geraint Thomas, they call him G, is the champion, and I think he will wear that with pride.
And now the mayor, Tony Beckett, will present the flowers, please, sir.
Well, Team Sky couldn't have had a better day than that. Let's go down to Graham again and find out who he's with at the podium.
And last but certainly not least, we're going to get the bottle of champagne poured on.
So a fantastic, beautiful day here in Pendle. It was certainly a beautiful day for Emma Pooley and for Geraint Thomas. They are the new British National Road Race champions. Rob Hills is still with me. Rob,
champion is Geraint Thomas, the silver medal.
Very worthy champion. And to be fair to Rob Hills, he called it correctly right from the start. I'm sure you're pretty. You look pretty smug. You're pretty pleased with yourself.
Oh, they've made us look pretty good, haven't they, today? But no, you know, a fantastic result there.
Clean sweep.
I'm really, really pleased for them. You know, I know all three of them very, very well. Any one of them, I would have loved to have won. Amazing. Incredible.
Thank you very much for joining us, and thank you for joining us as well. Tour de France comes up next week, and the British National Road Race jersey will be at it. Make sure you watch that, 4 o'clock on Saturday. Everybody here in Pendle, it's bye-bye.
What does it feel like, mate?
Feel it come to life when I see your ghost.